Hey, don't wake me up if I'm dreaming, but this is J. Anthony Frankie, and you're listening to On the Fly with Stevie and Worden. Cheers.
You are listening to On the Fly.
Surprises on this podcast, man, too.
What's up, guys? On the Fly is back again. And yes, these are the three ugliest mugs you'll probably ever see.
Well, two at least, anyway, Stevie.
Exactly.
Okay.
Me and Joe, you know.
I got it like that. And look, and I got jeans.
You're a beautiful specimen, Stevie.
I know.
I'm just pick that shirt up like this for the whole pod. Just wear your jeans on. Yeah,
And I'm representing.
Give me your money. Give me your money.
Gene Simmons
from Kiss.
From Kiss.
And I'm representing the guys from Boston. Aerosmith.
Okay. All right.
I saw this shirt online, and it had I think it's an old bootleg from the 70s because it's got the Alamo on there, and like I guess Houston. So it's like, oh, cool. It's a ripoff. I got it for like $20. So it's all right. Cool.
Okay. So.
Don't tonight. Brush that off, Stevie. It's a badass shirt, man. Oh, okay.
Okay. Whatever. Okay.
Journey rules. Journey.
I can't stand Aerosmith. I'm sorry. I can't stand them. Oh! I can't stand them. I hate them.
That's the way I feel about Journey. To each their own.
I know.
Do I love Joe Decker?
You know, I can't stand Kiss, though. Just kidding.
Yeah. No. Do you like Kiss? But anyway, do you like Aerosmith?
No.
Anyway.
Okay. See y'all later.
All right. Hey,
you want me to mute you now?
You do all the time, Stevie.
What? Anyway.
Peace
let's
out.
Let's get back on track here, Worden. We're getting off the trail. tonight, On the Fly is... We got our buddy, the third member of On the Fly down here, straight out of New York.
Well, he was, so he said that about Aerosmith. I don't know. I need to change my vote. Just kidding.
You just said they were from Boston. He's from New York, so.
Yeah.
So, this is true. Okay, I can get that now.
Get that, yeah.
This is a hatred.
What's up, Joe? How's everything?
Everything's good. How about you guys? Everything's great.
Good.
Great. Living the dream.
About to get a little chilly here, I think. Tomorrow morning is going to be – we got a freeze warning here tomorrow morning. How cold is it there in New York, Joe?
I got home about half an hour ago. It was 42 degrees when I got home. So, it's getting there.
Yeah.
It's going to be 58 here tomorrow. High. That's something for Texas.
That is bad for Texas.
That's cold.
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody will be going to HEB to stock up on supplies because it gets below 60. This town totally shuts down.
Got to buy bread, and milk.
Got to get the bread and milk.
Coffee.
I don't know what you're going to do with it. We're going to make milk sandwiches or something like that. That's what they do here. They always get the bread and the milk.
Bread and the milk.
Tonight.
Stevie, I'm just curious. Do you guys have like snow tires or like chains on tires up there? Mm-mm. It don't snow that much there, right? Not as much as New York, probably.
When we get it, for around here, like, one year, I think it was the first year I was married, I remember talking to my dad on the phone. They were talking about a storm coming through, and my dad was like, nah, it's going to be all rain. Next morning, I woke up, and it was up to this white rain was up to my back door.
White rain.
Yeah. And I was like, this is the funniest looking rain I've ever seen. But, we got it doesn't do it that much here. We didn't get a real significant snow at all last year. We got a few, like maybe inch and a half, something like that, but nothing big.
I remember the first time I ever saw snow, I had just moved to Missouri with my dad. And down here in Texas, we burn a lot of stuff, like, you know, we trash and stuff. So you always see the ashes flying. And I remember it started snowing and I saw all this snow coming down. I was like, where the hell is the fire at? Because it was just... those snowflakes look like ashes to me because I was used to it before.
Yeah.
You seen snow before though? You see what he's saying, Informer?
Informer.
You don't Joe gets it.
I know it.
One hit wonder right there, buddy.
Is he anyone the guy that became Everlast?
Oh, maybe.
Wasn't that him?
Ah, I don't know. That's a good
I thought point. One of them, like, he was known as one of those guys had a hit that used to be like some other guy.
Hold on.
That's your 90s trivia if you're listening.
We need to play the Jeopardy song. Snow. I don't
I thought one of them was like some kind of maybe Everlasting was like some other guy in the 80s and became somebody in the 90s. I don't know.
No.
I could be wrong. I'm not a hip hop fan. I'm not
it was not him. Let's see what Everlast. Maybe
he was somebody.
Was that the gosh, what's his name?
What's Everlast's song? There was like one song, right?
Oh God.
He was from House of Pain.
Okay, that's where it's from.
Also known as Whitey Ford.
Okay.
I don't know what. Known by the same name, Everlast is an American musician, singer, rapper, and songwriter who was
that was a big ass hit
for hip hop group House of Pain.
Did he sing What It's Like?
Yes, that's it.
Everybody knows just what it's like. That was a song.
Oh, yeah, he sang that.
They played the hell of that song.
They played that song to death. I hated it. I still hate it. Yeah,
it's almost like Aerosmith singing, huh?
It's not much worse. It's a little bit worse.
Oh shit!
That is a good idea for one of our next shows with Joe comes on. Songs that we absolutely hate.
I could, we could get those going. Mostly from the 90s. I wasn't a
bad couple downers here tonight. What the hell, man?
No, that's a good idea, though. We always look.
I'll just list the entire Journey catalog, and I'm done. So,
Before we just a real quick question for you guys, and it's really just based on opinion. Mm-hmm. Alice in Chains, grunge or no?
Yes, they're both. I think they're both because they started out rock before grunge was there.
I think
they kind of changed their sound to because Facelift is totally different than anything else they did.
Okay.
That's a balls out metal album because that came out before Nirvana.
I will have to go with they could be both.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Again, not to go off the rails completely, but I can't stand Nirvana. Like I'm not a fan at all. And to hear Alice in Chains, like to me there's no comparison. They're a rock band.
You talk about Alice in Chains, what about Stone Temple Pilots?
I love them.
That's the thing. They're a hard rock band. You know, I didn't get a grunge feel from them. You
consider them grunge or hard rock? I think because they came out when they did, a lot of people group them as grunge.
Yeah, I think
if they came out any other time, you'd call them a hard rock band.
Because Sex Type Thing, you couldn't see Pearl Jam playing Sex Type Thing. I mean, I never got the comparisons that when I liked STP. That they said they were ripping off Nirvana and Pearl Jam. I never got that.
No, I will say this: the first few times I heard STP, it sounded a little bit more like Pearl Jam.
I don't get that. Then
after that, though, you know, it was different. It was different.
And I agree with you.
I'm a bigger STP fan than I am Pearl Jam.
I agree with you, Joe. I think that Nirvana. They were at the right place at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Foo Fighters totally is much better. And I think Nirvana is so over. I like Nirvana. I didn't like them when they came out. I'm okay with them now. I mean, the first two, the ones that made them pop, they're okay. But I mean, I don't get the Smells Like Teen Spirit. I didn't know how that changed musical landscape. I still to this day don't get it. It's a different song, but it's no Cherry Pie, dude. Come on, man.
Exactly. And look, and I know I'll get crucified for this by everybody, but the best thing Nirvana ever did.
Don't say it, Stevie. Don't say it.
Was the Unplugged album.
Okay. Oh, yeah, that was good.
You know what? How many actual Nirvana songs did they do on the Unplugged?
Not too many.
It was mostly covers, wasn't it?
I think they did
what was that Bowie song they did?
They did the Man Who Sold the World. That is,
yeah, that's a bad. Awesome. Is that Bowie? Net Boy? Or am I? Yeah, yeah. That's a great cover.
They did that perfect. I mean, that's my favorite song on that whole.
They didn't do Smells Like Teen Spirit, did they? They did all Apologies and.
Was it Tom and Zeus talking about it on Dorm Damage about how when they were doing like the best, reading that list of best unplugged, it was just funny that they didn't do a lot of Nirvana, actual Nirvana songs. They did mostly covers, and they didn't
I think that's what they're talking about.
Yeah.
So, he just didn't care. Cobain just didn't care. Like,
he was like, you guys, just like they said, you guys think you're going to get Smell Like Teen Spirit. Well, guess what? Yeah. We're going to play Where Did You Sleep Last Night?
Yeah.
Stuff like that. And I liked a lot of those songs I hadn't heard before anywhere till they did them. But great album.
I read an article one time. It was probably in an anti-grunge magazine, and there was some insider saying that, you know, how big Pearl Jam and Nirvana get, and people like to say, oh, it was just an accident. Nothing ever done on accident. Radio quit playing the hair bands, and it drew people to that. I think it was more of that than it was of the hair bands. And that's my opinion, but what do I know?
Well, it all goes in phases, bud.
Yeah, it does. I
mean, you look at the early 80s, and you had that like semi-British invasion thing going on. And then you get to the 80s rock, and then you get to where the hip hop from back then was starting to get big. And then you go to grunge. I mean, it is what it is.
Have you ever noticed that a lot of people that were like metal, I mean, I've seen this with my friends, a lot of people that were like into hair bands and stuff like that in the 80s, they're in the country, because that's what country is nowadays. It's all, I mean, besides like Dixie Chicks and a few others, it's, I mean, you listen to the radio, it sounds like an 80s ballad most of the time with steel guitar.
Yeah.
And if that's your thing, cool. I mean, that ain't mine.
Whatever floats your boat.
Shania Twain, for instance, it was Def Leppard and, you know, with a hotter version. I ate it up too, because I loved her.
Well, that was like Pyromania too. You know, he wrote her an album of hits. You couldn't go wrong, you know.
And have you noticed that Def Leppard, AC/DC, and her, since he quit, haven't done anything without him?
Yeah.
I mean, their best stuff is with him.
He was a genius, bud.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Now he's producing like Britney Spears and like pop bands. So he knows where the money's at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
So tonight, the main event tonight is our top 10. And let's make this, and I sent the text out last night. Let's make this perfectly clear here. Top 10, our top 10. Favorite guitar player. So when we get crucified for not having so-and-so up here, or so-and-so didn't make the list, you guys are crazy. Well, guess what? Yeah, we are crazy, but that has nothing to do with how we picked our list.
I have a feeling tonight's gonna be one of them. No, sorry.
Oh god.
I have a feeling that
roast.
Thanks, Paul. I have a feeling that our lists are going to be different. I think they're going to have some same, but I just see in our list being different. Cause I think my number one is, I don't know if you guys have my number one on your list. I'm making that prediction right now. I could be wrong. You know, I just don't think my number one fits y'all's criteria. I think you like him. Okay. But
that's the thing that's great about when we do this list, is cause you get to hear, you know, maybe somebody that you wouldn't have even thought of.
Right.
I think there's a couple of mine up here that probably won't be on you guys' list.
I can see that.
Interesting.
Benny Vincent, right? Number one.
Dang, you just gave him.
I got
you.
Mark St. John, dude. I knew it.
Mark St. John.
No,
I need Tim.
So we're so we're gonna go through the list. So like, if say Joe has my number three, I'm not gonna say anything until I get my number three.
Right.
Just hold
and
it.
And we can
hold
and we can circle later. Back and hit Stevie's 50 honorable mentions.
Yep, exactly. 52 today.
It's a tough one too. Like I struggle similar to our Eagles show. I struggled. I mean, my top two are a lock. They're a lock.
Yeah.
You know.
Through
10. Depends on my mood. They could be, they're interchangeable. It depends on what I want to listen to on that particular day.
My top 10 are set. These are the ones that my top 10, I have no qualms about them.
All right.
I have honorable mentions, but Joe's a musician, so he may kind of look at his stuff a little bit different
than what we do.
I mean, the only thing I can play is the radio. So
one of my top five is probably going to It's probably gonna shock Worden. Joe may not shock Joe so much, but probably gonna shock Worden.
I'm curious about our overlap and guys that you talk about that I maybe haven't, like you mentioned, you're number one. I'm dying to hear that one. He's not even on my list.
Of course, I don't know. I mean, that's what I think.
Right.
Of course,
right.
I'll probably mention a couple of Stevie's never heard of. You know, who's that guy? Well, he played on that third album from so and so, and I love that album.
I'm
not that bad.
Unless you got some freaking ghost session player that I don't know about.
I think my list represents me and what I like. If you know me, you'll know what I like.
That's what it should be.
I think that, but I think maybe my order may be a little bit I don't know if my number one, but you know, like you said, let's get to it, man.
Like Joe said, his top two is a lock. My top three is a lock. 4 through 10 could go either way.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it could go any way there.
But you know what Joe's going to do, Stevie, right? He's going to get there and he's going to go, you know why he's my favorite? Because he did this chord progression. It was an E and then he went to the here and then
yeah.
We're going to be like, huh?
I thought about that. Talking about ghost notes and
yeah.
Edgios.
We're going to be like,
is it you know what me and Worden are going to do? We're going to be like,
huh?
All right. So top 10 favorite. What we're saying is
our number 10.
Number
10.
Right.
Greatest, what our favorite?
Yeah, our picks.
Our picks. All right, let's start it out with Mr. Decker.
Oh man!
Here we go. Chord progression.
Well, it's funny that you pick, I'm going to pick this guy first because it's probably someone that Worden can't stand. But I'm going with Neil Sean from Journey. I love every note the man plays. The fact that he was playing in Santana at 17 years old is just ridiculous. And he was phenomenal in that band.
He was good in Bad English. I don't have anything against them.
The man is just
I'm kidding.
A master. He was good though. He was good. Master guitar player. I mean, he's the kind of guy that just can play one note. The man knows how to pick notes when he plays. He follows along a melody. He can shred with the best of them, but chooses not to. His restraint is what really impresses me the most. He'll sit back and play nice melodic lines where most guys just want to just fly as fast as they can. And he has so many, you know, those iconic Don't Stop Believing, Faithfully, you know, Who's Crying Now? So many of those just amazing solos that everyone can just almost like hum in their head right along with them because they're so melodic and he just knows how to choose the right notes. So again, he's I hate putting him at number 10, but that's where he lands today. He's number 10.
Gotcha.
I think Joe will agree on something that you can't stand Aerosmith and I can't stand Journey, but I think both of us can agree that there's no question their musicianship for those guys in the band. Yeah, exactly. Easy for just like gymnasium. That they're both talented. It's just not my cup. It's just
no doubt.
And I don't hate Journey. I don't despise Journey. It's just not my cup of tea. It's just that's
I get it. I get it.
I love.
You know, I'm not a fan of their stuff right now. I'm a big Journey dork, but I'm like Steve. You know, back in the original Journey. Yeah. You know, like we're not
before
even the original.
Steve,
like,
before Steve Perry.
No, I like that stuff, but the Steve Perry stuff from there up until the Raised on Radio album. And then when they had that like reunion album they had up for,
Trial by Fire.
That was really good. And
yeah, it was.
They're supposed to tour for that. They never did. And that upset me. And, you know, I hear some of Journey's stuff they have out now with that new singer. And then they did a whole bunch of, they did a remaster with the new singer, old songs that are pretty good. But, you know, it's not the same. It's like a cover band almost now, you know.
But honestly, I mean, people don't care. They're still selling out stadiums.
Yeah. They will. Well, they're doing it right. They're going out with Foreigner. They're going out with a lot of the 80s. You said Toto, you know.
Toto. So get ready to start next year with Toto.
I'd probably go see that show because
I would go see it.
Yeah, I'd probably go to that. I wouldn't go see
wouldn't,
Journey.
Stevie, you wouldn't go. You don't go to concerts.
Well, that's because, unlike you, they're like 2.5-3 hours from here is the closest one to me
now.
Yeah. It's true. So. Got to give you that, Worden. Brother.
All right.
To get your number 10.
Okay.
Neil Sean, right?
Number, what's that?
Neil Sean, right? No, your number
Neil
10.
Sean.
You know, Joe, it's amazing. I have just seen the light. I do love one Journey song I found the other day. It came on Shuffle. And I think because it sounds like a hair band show, like you could see like a hair band doing this song, I'll Be All Right Without You.
Oh, yeah.
That is a badass song. It is. I like Steve Perry solo stuff like Foolish Heart Oh, Sherry. I like that stuff.
Oh, Sherry. Yeah.
A lot of it's fatigue with me. I don't hate them. You know, I mean, it's not that I can't stand them. I hate.
There's a lot of great tunes in that race.
No, Stevie, it ain't that. No. No, don't Suzanne. Don't sadder yourself.
Suzanne was a good song. Yeah.
Thong? What are we talking about?
Suzanne was a good song.
Not I heard thong, man. It's like, hey, what are we talking about?
You hear
here?
What you want.
Where's your mind? Yeah.
In the gutter, as I usually.
In the ghetto, dude.
Elvis.
Okay. Yes. Great song. My number 10.
Okay, here we go.
No, the original guitarist is not better. And the only fans that give this guy crap are fans of the other band.
Oh, here we go.
He is very, I think he gets a lot of crap from Metallica fans for replacing Dave Mustaine.
Mm.
I think he's better than Mustaine. I'm not a big Dave Mustaine fan. Megadeth's okay, but I love me some Kirk Hammett.
Okay.
I'm a big Metallica fan, and he's been in the band since I've been there. I hear a lot of my friends are Megadeth fans saying, oh, Dave's better. No, Dave's not better. Their best stuff was Master On, in my opinion. Their first two albums were good. I love Kirk Hammett, and, you know, haters be damned. You know, he's a great guitar player.
I will agree with that. I think Kirk is better than Dave. It's no question they took off after Master, that was what got them on the scene. And then Injustice for All really took off. And then, of course, the Black Album
went
to another stratosphere. But yeah,
but his stuff's on the Black Album was great. I mean, I like the Load and Reload stuff, but I'm a Metallica fan. But,
have you ever watched the documentary, A Year in a Life and a Half of? I mean, just watching him lay down
Bob Rock
solos.
Especially when he does The Unforgiven, when he can't get it right. And Bob Rock goes, okay, do it your way. And he just blows up that solo. Yes.
I love that. That is a great documentary there. If any of you haven't seen that yet, I can't imagine if you're our age, you haven't watched A Year and a Half in the Life of.
That's where the whole Kip Winger photo came in.
Yes,
they're throwing darts at him and stuff.
I did. That was really good. And I like how Bob Rock challenged him, like, come on, guitar player of the year. Show me what you got. Show me what you got. He's pissing him off so bad, you know. But that's what a great producer does. He brings out the best in you by pissing you off sometimes. And
exactly.
And I'm with you. I don't think that Dave Mustaine could tie Kirk's shoes. I mean, seriously. Like, I'm not a big Megadeth fan at all or a fan of Dave Mustaine. I think the guys that play guitar in Megadeth are better than you know, Marty Friedman. Those guys are better than Davis. So, I was I kind of fell off Metallica after the Black Album, but that early stuff when I was in high school, you know, the Ride the Lightning, Kill 'Em All, love that stuff.
Yeah, Black Album, and then when Load came out, mm-hmm. Load, I liked Load, I did. I mean, everybody was like, oh no, they're selling out, they cut their hair,
whatever.
I'm like, dude, really? It's good music. Good music is good music.
But, I liked every album they've done except Saint Anger and that one they did with
Lulu.
Yeah, I just like, what the hell?
Yeah,
I love Death Magnetic and I love the new and I love the.
They kind of got back to their roots with Death Magnetic. They got back to their roots and I mean, and the last
that was more Master of Puppets type. What was the one that just came out? 10 years ago, I guess. That's not Death Magnetic. What was the one?
The one after that. I can't remember which one.
Yeah. That just came out. And that's kind of like more master into like.
I mean, Death Magnetic, you could tell they were getting back to their roots there. They were going away from, you know, the Load, the Reload, and definitely went away from Saint Anger.
Some of the best tracks on those Load and Reload are the ones that didn't release. Like The House That Jack Built.
All right, Hardwired to Self-Destruct is the last one.
Bleeding Me, just there's a lot of good stuff.
Outlaw Torn, isn't that on Load?
Yeah,
that was a good one.
Yeah, I got one more comment about Kirk. As I was thinking through it in my head just now, I've seen Metallica live a number of times, and I have to say that he is one of the few metal hard rock guitar players that I would say stays very, very true to what he's recorded. A lot of guys, you see, you'll do a song and they do, you've got a solo in your head that you're waiting to hear, and they go off on a whole other route, maybe hit a few of the notes on there, the main ones, but then they're going a different direction. He stays very, very true to what he recorded, which tells me he planned it. Like he wrote that solo for that song. He wasn't just jamming. They hit record, then they put it all together later on. And we'll talk about that later on with a different guitar player. But he plays his stuff almost note for note when I've seen him live. He doesn't stray very often at all, which I like.
I noticed that too. Yeah, you're right, Joe.
You watch a live video of him. You're right, exactly. He does not stray from what he recorded in the studio.
Yeah, and I like that.
So, number 10.
Mm-hmm.
Worden.
Chubby guess Checker.
guess what?
Neil Sean.
Neil Sean, buddy. Oh, that's I'm great. Telling you. First,
Y'all called each other and shared y'all's list. I know what y'all did.
That's what we're doing right here. That's what we're doing. But, I mean, just like Joe said, playing with Santana at 17 and then starts Journey, gets in Journey. And I'm going to tell you what, the solo to Don't Stop Believing, I'm glad you said that, Waller, is one of the best solos you ever hear. I mean, he absolutely kills it. I know you're shaking your head.
You say so, Stevie. Hey, it's your podcast, man.
And look, like you said, he was not bad in Bad English, pun intended. But
which is kind of funny how I disliked that. Bad English was like the first band, like I saw him open up for Whitesnake in 90. That was like my first like real concert, you know.
I'll tell you another thing you do too, Worden. You were talking about you like that song, I'll Be All Right Without You. Go watch the video.
I did.
And watch him play that guitar solo on that and kind of leading the outro to it. I mean, because he kills it on that too.
Oh, you don't have to show me the guy. I mean, I'm not going to cut. I mean, just because I don't like somebody, I don't mean they're not talented. It's just, like I said,
that is a good one to look at. It's got it's a live performance and he's killing it. I mean, but Neil Sean, me and Joe got our first duplicate, and you messed the whole thing up right there. You could have picked Neil Sean at 10. Jeez.
And that would be a lie.
Do you remember, remember Hearing Aid? Remember that metal project?
Stars, Hearing Aid. Stars.
We Are Stars or whatever.
Neil Sean in there. There's Neil Sean. Next Steve to Perry Van Malmsteen, Vivian Campbell, George Lynch, the guys from Iron Maiden. And here's Journey guitar player Neil Sean dropping him in there, and he tore it up. I remember watching the documentary on the making of that, where they showed the extended guitar solos and the guys were actually just jamming around and they put it together. And people were just watching him in awe. Like, just he was just killing it, you know.
The guy could play for any metal band out
absolutely.
There and still be great.
I mean, Journey's pretty close to being like, I don't want to say hair band, but a hard rock band. So
they're close.
I mean, they're on the cusp of it.
They are. Yeah. They are.
All right. Number 9 for Joe.
Man, oh man. I hate to. Okay. So if you number pick, 9 is one of those picks where he's not obscure, but he's not a super popular guitar player. He is amongst guitar players. Like, guys will talk about him a lot. They were influenced by him. Particularly for his blues playing, Gary Moore.
Okay.
You've heard of Gary Moore? No one knows Gary Moore?
Yeah.
Okay. I know Gary Moore.
I found him when I was probably in 14 and 9th grade. Somebody played a song called Shapes of Things for me by him, and the solo was just ridiculous. And after I heard that, I just wanted to get everything he had. He was a Thin Lizzy back in the day, and Vivian Campbell was very influenced by him. The guy's got a very, very interesting combination between playing some just killer blues, but just straight out, metal, hard rock. And the influences he has, it integrates so well together. Plus his tone, his phrasing. I just love the guy. So that's my number 9.
Hey, I remember that song. I Still Got the Blues. I used to play the hell of that here. I like that song.
Yeah.
Great song.
And honestly, sadly, that's the only thing I really know from him. And that's him being such a great guitarist, that's sad.
That's something I don't know a whole lot from him. Yeah. I'll definitely have to
check him out. I mean, I think one of the things that hurt him was he wanted to be a solo artist, and he hasn't got the best voice in the world. He sings in his band, and his voice, it's okay. But he was like, you know, he's out there in front, and he plays the shit out of the guitar, but as far as his vocal goes, it's just okay. So that may have hurt him, but he's kind of one of those guys, like, he'd pack a house, you know, probably very popular, you know, in Europe more than here in the States. I never saw him live.
I hate to say this, though. Another thing that's probably hurting him with the not just singing, he's not what you would call a handsome man.
He's not. He's definitely not a handsome man. No, he's definitely not.
I remember that song being so popular. Was it like in the early 90s or something, like late 80s, early 90s? Still got the blues.
Probably, yeah, yeah.
But I think what hurt him too also is I remember I heard this song and I heard Gary Moore, and Stevie will back me up on. There was a country singer in the 80s called Gary Morris.
Okay.
He did a song called I'll Lasso You the Moon before Beth Midler did. Okay. And I was thinking, is that him? You know, and I was like, you know, before the internet and stuff, that could have hurt him too. Who knows?
You're right. Before the internet, you couldn't look it up.
Because I thought it was. I was like, oh, Gary Morris is going rock now.
Right. Right.
Because you hear it wrong on the radio, you don't know what it is.
I've never seen him live. He's one of the few guys I've never seen live. I can't picture him ever even touring. I'm sure he did the States, but, you know, I could picture him being an opening act for like an Iron Maiden or a Judas Priest. But to best of my knowledge, that never happened. And I never saw him. You know, there's some, if you want to check him out, though, there's some awesome live stuff on YouTube of him playing, you know, and again, the vocals, I think, are what hurt him. The vocals
he's no longer with us. Didn't he? He passed away, right?
He passed away maybe 10 years ago.
Yeah, been that long. Wow.
Yeah, 2011.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, it's been a little while. So he's the guy.
All right, Gary Moore, number 9. He's Worden.
Okay, my number 9, I'm with Joe that it's hard for me to pick this guy low. It's not the same pick, Joe.
Yeah.
This is probably the most, in my opinion, probably the most talented guitar player on my list overall. And he, a lot of times, is considered the third best in the band, but I would put him number 2. And I love his stuff with the Beatles. I love his solo stuff. What is Life? My Sweet Lord. George Harrison.
Okay.
So underappreciated, in my opinion. Better than John Lennon. Paul McCartney is just an amazing, I mean, I think his longevity proved it. But I think, you know, I think they should have included George more, and they made him an outcast. I think they were a little intimidated by him.
Probably.
But when I hear the Beatles, I think two people. I think Paul McCartney and I think George Harrison. And I used to be a big John Lennon fan. But the more I listen to the Beatles, and I'm a big Beatles fan, And his solo stuff is just so great. I mean, a lot of people know, you know, Stuck on You or, you know, but he's got, you know, just so many good songs. And I do a playlist and I find a lot of George Harrison stuff on that playlist. That's like a Beatles playlist along with Paul McCartney.
Nice.
That's George Harrison. You know, everybody, of course, talks about the Beatles stuff. I'm a big fan of like the Go-Go's, Belinda Carlisle, her stuff. My favorite Belinda song with her solo artist was Leave a Light On.
Oh, and I love that song.
George Harrison plays a slide guitar in that. I
heard about that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So
I forgot to mention also his stuff they did with the Traveling Wilburys. God, that was great. Was
freaking awesome. That I just hate you didn't. Yeah,
they're all gone except Jeff Lynn.
All gone. I can watch that video for what's the big song?
Everybody would care.
Somebody to lean on. I can watch that video.
They were having so much fun in that video.
Oh, what a great song. You know? And how Tom Petty, you know, Roy Orbison, like you said, you know,
Bob Dylan's still around.
Oh, yeah, Jeff Lynne and Bob Dylan. That's right.
I forget about Bob Dylan. Bob Dylan's still around.
Is he?
He's been dead since the 60s. It don't matter. and I remember growing up, you know, of course, my mom was a Beatles fan and growing up with them and stuff. And I remember got my mind set on you. And it's like, that's the side of George Harrison I never saw because he always seemed so serious.
Yep.
And when he did My Sweet Lord, and it's just, I mean, God, it just, I mean, awesome guitar. And it just pains me that I couldn't rate him higher.
That Wilburys, that came out. When was that?
Late 80s. Late 80s. That's like when Roy Orbison kind of made his comeback.
Died. Yeah.
Yeah. He did that. You got it or whatever right before he died.
And
yeah.
And he was, you know, I think he was only like 52 when he died.
He wasn't very old. No.
He looked like he was 70, you know, in those videos.
It came out in 88.
Yeah.
See, that's so okay. So that sounds about right because, you know, 88, I was definitely at the height of like all in metalhead. But I remember hearing that Wilbury song and loving it, which was so not something I would like, you know, back at that point in time in my life. But I remember seeing that video and just thinking this was a really freaking cool song. And again, just the way that they were all interacting, it looked so genuine. Like they were really, really enjoying playing with each other. You know, it was awesome. Yeah.
See, there's a song I think that they traveled with where it's kind of, it came out late 80s and it was pretty heavy. I think it's She's My Baby or something like that.
Okay.
That's got if you're going to check it out, that's got a real heavy kind of guitar to it that, you know.
Nice.
And, you know, everybody says the Beatles invented, you know, with Helter Skelter. You listen to Revolution or what's the one? Everybody. What's that song? It escapes my mind. Nike had it on a commercial.
Say you want a revolution.
God, that's metal right there.
Yeah.
Man.
But they the Wilburys, that I didn't realize they had a volume 3.
Yeah.
I didn't either.
They released a second album after Orbison's death in December of 88 called Travel Wilburys volume 3. I'm going to check that. That was in 1990. Wow. But let me tell you, you speak of Jeff Lynne. And let me tell you, you know, you guys know I do my like album challenge over the last 2 years. And I like Electric Light Orchestra for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
I listened to their album from 71, No Answer. And let me tell you what, I wish I hadn't answered that because God, it's God awful. Do Is not
really
stay bad? Away from it. Stay that away
bad.
From it.
What's wrong with it? What's bad about it? I'm curious.
Well, for one thing, there's not a lot of lyrics to it. There's mostly, and there's nothing wrong with it being like mostly instrumental, but the songs sound like, and I guess they did it on purpose because if you look at the names of some of the songs up there, it sounds like it's from like olden times, from like the 1800s.
Okay.
It's kind of Jethro Tull-ish, I guess, in a way, but yeah.
A flute playing in the background?
No, I mean, it didn't have the flute, but it's just got that feel like. And I'm like, really?
I just remember
you guys hadn't really hit your prime yet with ELO yet.
I just remember with ELO when I had to watch all those anti-rock commercials.
Rock and roll thing.
And they had that one where it plays backwards. And it's like, and it says it and they're playing it and they're going, this is in like full sentence. The music is reversible.
Yeah.
Like, how do they get it to do it? You don't think they did that on purpose, do you?
I remember,
but that freaked the hell out of me. But yeah, I love you, Elo.
George Harrison is your number 9. That's good. Okay, my number 9. He was on
Hee Haw.
Yeah, Hee Haw.
Whoa.
Yeah. Actually, what's his name? Gosh, what was his name on there?
Roy Clark.
Roy Clark. Oh, yeah,
Clark's good dude.
Oh, that man
can play a banjo.
That man. Yeah. You see him on this is really dating myself. Did you see when he was on The Odd Couple?
No, I didn't.
With Jack Klugman and Tony Randall?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I didn't see that.
He did a cameo. Check that out on YouTube sometime. He tore that guitar inside out on that show. Oh, it was amazing.
It's funny with him. I grew up watching Hee Haw as a kid. Mm-hmm. He's always bald. And then I saw him like he was in, I think, New Orleans, like in the 80s at the World's Fair or something. He had like a full head of hair. And it's like, nobody's not going to believe that's not a wig, dude.
Yeah, little. My number 8 is a little different than Roy Clark. Or number 9, excuse
number
me.
Number 9, yeah, number 9.
Yeah, excuse me. He was on two albums that, well, one album that made me a fan of this artist and kind of got the shaft from them and then went on to be in a band that made just a great, great album, debut album, and then disappeared for a long time. And
I know who it is.
It's came back recently in the last 5 or 6 years and it still does a great job, but Jakey Lee.
I knew you were going to say that. All right.
Jakey Lee. I can remember hearing The Ultimate Sin for the first time, and I'm like, this freaking guitar on here is just kicks butt. And I had, at that time, I wasn't an Ozzy fan. Mm-hmm. So I went backwards and listened to Bark at the Moon. And oh, jeez, wow. And can you imagine the pressure on this guy to following Randy Rhoads? I mean, and just in that line of guitar players, I mean, Jakey Lee held his own. And I mean, Jakey Lee could write songs. Doesn't get a lot of credit for the songs he wrote when he was with Ozzy. And because Sharon doesn't want him to
get I wonder why. Yeah.
And then goes on with Badlands. And I mean, you guys heard, if you haven't heard the Badlands album, it's good. Freaking
great. Awesome. Great.
I mean, that band should have been huge. And I know Tom and Zeus.
Timing.
And you know, they had the singer. They had the guitar player. They had it all. They had but just like you said, Warden, timing was a little bit off. If this had been 3 years before, geez, this band would have been huge. But yeah, Jake Lee comes back after a long, long absence, and Red Dragon Cartel, which isn't a bad band. But yeah, I'll always remember him. Ultimate Sin. I always go back and think of Jake Lee as Ultimate Sin.
Yeah, I know he does bullshit. Great. I think it's bullshit that they go back and like, I read some of the stories about how she made them go back and like, I guess sign something and they took them to Europe or something. The dude was Jakey Lee. I read he was living in his van for a while. A guy that plays stadiums like that, they should have, I mean, it ain't like Ozzy's going to miss that stuff. And I don't think it's so much Ozzy. I don't think he has an idea what that was going on.
I think Ozzy would have been all for it, but I think Sharon
taking the money or paying him?
No, paying him. Ozzy would have paid him if it was Ozzy's decision.
My first Ozzy album was Bark at the Moon. Yeah. And I think probably my all-time favorite Ozzy Osbourne song is Rock and Roll Rebel. Yeah. And that, I mean, every time that comes on, dude, and I mean, great, man. I mean, and
look at some of the freaking videos from back then when Jake was in the band, was in Ozzy's band. They had a whole live performance from the Ultimate Sin tour. Guy kicks ass. I mean, no doubt about it. I just hate he missed all those years after Badlands. I think it just with everything that went on with Ray Gillen and the album getting shelved and all this stuff, I think it just left a bad taste. And he was like, you know, screw it. I don't have to deal with this drama.
I think he was bitter.
I don't blame him.
I think it had soured him. And
I mean, he had a bad instance with Ozzy's band. And then that happened. I was like, you know, screw it. I don't have to do this right now. But I just hate he missed all that time.
Yeah.
When he could have been kept on putting out great work. But number nine for me is Jakey Lee.
I loved you. I remember when Bark at the Moon came out. I remember a friend and I being at the record store that day. We both bought the album that day. They'd been hyping it up in like the Hit Parader magazine, Circus magazine for a while. This hotshot guitar player is coming in, this Jakey Lee guy. We don't think anything about him other than he looks like he's kind of like Asian mixed or something. This massive, you know, black hair. And then they put the video out for Bark at the Moon, which was very, very cool, and watching him play. I saw him on that tour. I saw the Ozzy Bark of the Moon tour, which is incredible. And I'll talk more about Jake versus another guitar player a little bit later on. But
who opened up for that Ozzy in that tour? Was it Metallica?
Oh my gosh, it was Motley Crue on the South of the Devil tour. It was unbelievable. Wow. I mean, that was like
the Botchery 101
when they were dangerous. They were a dangerous band, you know. And
back when Vince could sing,
when he could, he still couldn't sing, but at least he looked better
in the studio. He could. Singing.
He looked better, you know, not singing back then.
Not as much of a phase in his past.
He didn't look like the Abominable.
Woo. No, that's the tour you hear about when you see it on the Dirt movie, or you see the Dirt book with Ozzy and. I'll never forget though. We had pretty good seats. It was in Philadelphia. It was Ozzy, Motley Crue, and a band called Wasted was the first band.
Oh, that was what's the name from Def Leppard's old band, right?
It was a guy from I think UFO, Pete May, something like that. I forget.
I thought that Phil Collin was in that band too.
He might have been
Def Leppard. I think so.
He may have been in that band.
But it was a guy from UFO.
They had like one popular song out that I remember them playing, but there was one part of the show where Jake swapped out guitars and we had pretty good seats. And I don't know what happened, but I think his guitar tech did not tune the guitar properly. and he was staring he couldn't do anything about it. I remember just staring daggers off the side of the stage. I'm thinking, okay, this guy lost his job, because the guitar was so, he's pulling the bar, trying anything to get the thing to sink back in. And it was just, he had to just finish the song. I think it was during,
of course, Joe's the musician in the audience and notices that. The rest of it's like, we wouldn't know. We wouldn't know any difference.
I could see his face. Most performers, like, you just on with the show, you just get through it. He was clearly very, very unhappy about what was happening. But he was phenomenal live. He was phenomenal live. He's a great showman. He plays very, very true to what he recorded as well. And and he was a really good sidekick. I think after Randy, remember how Ozzy and Randy would play off each other a lot? He kind of lost that. Like, he didn't do that a lot with Brad Gillis. But he and Jake had a pretty good playoff as well, and it was fun to watch.
Yeah. Pete Way was one in Wasted.
That was what it was.
I didn't see anything about Phil Collin being in there. I think it's another. I think I cannot remember.
The band Girl. That's the band.
Yeah,
Girl.
That's Red Girl.
Is he with like, wasn't the dude from LA Guns with him or something, Phil Lewis?
Tracy Guns.
Yeah, Tracy. Yeah, Wasted is a Def Leppard song. That's where I was getting it from.
That's right. Wasted. Yeah.
I'm not even Wasted, so what do I know?
Because by then, that would have been like 83, 84. By then, I think Phil was already with Def Leppard with the,
Pyromania.
Yeah.
All right. Number 8 for Joe.
Oh my gosh. All right. Again, I said these are all going to be interchangeable, but just to go down my list. Now, this is a guitar player who his playing is what the band is all about. Without him, this band would not even exist. Multi-talented. He could play anything: acoustic, electric, slide, sit down pedal steel. Not a big hard rock guy by any stretch of the imagination, but his guitar playing sets the mood for the songs. And I've never heard the guy play a bad note, and that's David Gilmour from Pink Floyd. I'm not a huge Floyd fan, but his playing is just so unbelievably good. He's a guy that just he's not a shredder by any stretch of the imagination, but he just knows the notes to play, and he sets such a mood. I've seen them live a number of times, and he's the reason for that band. If there was never a David Gilmour, there was never that band,
Not even Roger Waters with the lyrics or nothing like that?
The lyrics.
I don't know. I'm not a Pink Floyd fan. I always hear about Roger Waters. That's the only one I know. That's the only other guy I know.
me too. Besides,
he does the music. I figure somebody's doing the lyrics.
The one album I listened to all the way through,
like one lyric,
was mostly guys' phones ringing in the background. I got to go, give me my pardon, I mean, I'm like, where is this big thing that I'm not getting it from Pink Floyd?
Wall. That was probably the Wall album.
Yes, it was.
I heard that I was probably in third or fourth grade, and that was a really weird album to hear at that age, because there's so many weird things happening in it. And the whole album, it's a concept. It tells a story, and I've watched the movie a bunch of times. I still don't understand what
stoned or sober.
Probably both, probably both at one point, But that is music where you need headphones. That Wall's got earworms everywhere. And again, he's not a huge fan of the band at all, but his playing, I'm a huge fan. And I still follow him on Instagram. He's probably the coolest, almost 80-year-old guy that walks the face of the earth. If I could be anywhere near as cool as that and still playing like at that level at 80 years old, that'd be something to shoot for.
You ever done the Dark Side of the Moon with Wizard of Oz?
I've never done it. I want to do.
You heard
one.
You can.
I thought it was I thought it was Mickey Mouse. Isn't there?
I thought it was Wizard of Oz and Dark. I mean,
probably several of them. They've tried.
Maybe.
All I remember about Pink Floyd is you can't have your pudding if you ain't got your meat.
Exactly. Exactly. I just remember. Well, that was the big song. That album for the hey, teacher, leave those kids alone.
Yeah,
that song. All over the radio. I mean, that was a huge, huge radio song.
It was worse than Korn did it.
Oh, I hated that. I hated that.
I liked it either.
That wasn't fun.
No. Wasn't good either.
No.
So number 8 for you, Warden?
Number 8 for me is another guy. There's been a lot of talk about this gentleman in the news lately that he's about to be replaced. And if he's replaced, it's the end of the band, if you ask me. Yeah, they can get rid of the singer and the drummer, but not the bass player in this band and not the guitar player, and that's Mick Mars.
Oh, yeah. I've heard
very,
that.
Very underrated. That's the Motley sound, is Mick Mars. And they're talking about John 5, and I like John 5 with Zombie. And I think John 5's denied it. They start these rumors with no backing about it. I mean, if he leaves, I mean, like I said, you can get rid of Tommy, you can get rid of Vince and still continue on, but you won't be able to get rid of Nicky because he's a songwriter, or Mick.
Yeah.
I love Motley. I love them. They were my favorite band at one time. And Mick Mars has always been a constant because I just think he's very in that band, you know. I think look at him now. I mean, he's still shredding and he's in bad shape. Guy can still play, evidently.
Recently, killing the solo for Home Sweet Home. I was like, damn, go Mick. Like, he looks terrible.
Yeah.
He almost doesn't
look. Well, he always has, actually.
Yeah. I mean,
he's never been an attractive man.
You know, I think about it. If I really count up my concerts, I've probably seen Motley Crue the most, you know. Really? And I'm not a huge, I like him. I'm not a huge fan. I'm not a huge, huge fan, but their tours were always good. He always played really, really well. And I think he got better in time. His playing
I see that.
Progressed. And even that video I saw just recently where he really looks, poor guy looks bad. But man, he was playing great.
One of my favorite solos is Home Sweet Home.
Love that.
That's how he goes, that one.
Love it.
And I love the intro to Dr. Feelgood, play. And of course, Kickstart My Heart, which they totally ripped off Montrose, but nobody knew Montrose back in '89.
Yeah.
Unless, you know, us. But I mean, Girls, Girls, Girls is my favorite Motley album of all time, next to the Black album. But there was rumors about him doing something with Karabi in it, and I guess it never worked out. That would have been great, just those two together.
Yeah, that would have been interesting there. Mick is probably the unsung MVP of Motley Crue over the years.
Oh, definitely.
For the guy to be sitting there, go through with the condition he has, and to be playing like he does.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, the guy's in pain. He's got to be in pain.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, so bad that when they got back together the time before last, when they found him, he was in really, really bad shape. And, Mick Mars, not what you would call a handsome man, but can play the hell out of a guitar.
That tells you right there that none of them are really close to each other, because Nicky's out in Montana. I mean, Tommy's still acting like he's 25. Vince is, I don't know about Vince.
Vince is Vince.
Yeah, Vince is, that's a whole podcast by itself, but yeah.
Have you seen those videos where they have him singing gibberish and then they put like pretend
put the words? Yeah,
those are the best.
I cried. I laughed so hard. I cried. When
I read that last week that Nikki Sixx compared Vince Neil to Robert Plant, and I'm going, "Are you back on that drugs, dude?" Or
what?
Yeah, there was something on there. I think. Yeah, he said that Vince couldn't sing in his prime, not outside the studio anyway.
Robert Plant has never been compared to the Abominable Snowman, that's for sure.
That's for sure. Those videos are great. I wish they'd make more of those, because I watch those and I can't even believe it's real. Like that he's actually out there just, and people are going, you know.
Biggest tour of the year.
I'll tell you this, like my nephew who went to see him, he's, 19, 20 now. He went to see him and he said, "I don't care." Cause I asked him, how's it going to be with Vince, with his voice? And he was like, "Dude, the main thing I'm going for is just to be there, just get to see him." And I said, "Well, that's got to be what it is." And he actually said, and this was one of the first shows that they did, and he said he really wasn't that bad. So,
He's bad.
Not that bad for him.
He's bad. We're just used to it. I mean, it's like Paul and Kiss. I mean, I honestly see your nephew's point, because I saw him and I know he can't sing, but it's Kiss to me, you know.
Yeah,
and I'll go see him again when they come close to me. I mean, you only live once, so I'll go see him. And Gene doesn't have enough of my money already. So, but I wasn't going to give any to Motley Crue. Ever since I saw them on that, you talk about mailing it in. I saw them on that Crew Fest, and I think 6 a.m. open. Nikki was fine. Tommy was fine. Mick was fine. Vince, he wasn't even trying.
Yeah, he's shy.
And this was just two years after the Red Rotten Crew, which Vince was great. I saw that tour when they did Red Rotten Crew with If I Die Tomorrow. He was awesome. 2 years later, I got paid. I don't care.
Yep. That's what it is. That's what it's all about, the money now. Okay. Number 8 for me. Mm-hmm. And this is going to be the first one that probably surprised Worden. And it may surprise Joe. He's well respected, I think, in the guitar world, but he wasn't out there enough to really be like, I think he could have been the superstar. He was pretty good, but Nuno Bettencourt from Extreme.
Okay.
I mean, to listen to the first Extreme album, and I know, you know, some of the songs sounds like he's shredding like Benny, like, but yeah, and then he can do pretty much anything. Porno Graffiti was just a masterpiece from start to finish. And, you know, everybody knows More Than Words. But, man, the guy can freaking play. And I think, you know, when they broke up and he decided he wanted to go out on his own, and then Gary Cherone went with Van Halen, which was a mistake, he kind of disappeared from the limelight. But he, you know, they're back again. I think Extreme is back again. But, man, could he freaking play. And I was just – when I heard – actually, what was the name of that freaking song that they had on the first Extreme album that was so daggum good? And I cannot.
Mama Don't Want to Go to School Today?
Yes, that's it. That's it. Yeah, from that sort, I was like, this is going to be a good band. And it was all because – it wasn't because I was listening to Gary Cherone's lyrics. It's because I heard Nuno's guitar. And I think they did the song they did where he – sounds like Benny on it was on the Bill and Ted Excellent Adventure soundtrack.
At the water park or whatever.
No, it was when they were they were at the mall.
Oh, okay. One of those. Yeah. I thought it was kind of I think they went back and forth, you know.
Yeah, they were at the mall. But yeah, and then he did guitar on Janet Jackson on Black Cat.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
You know, man, Vernon Reed. I think there was another version that Vernon Reed did. So there were two versions.
So he did the rhythm guitar on Black Cat. So Vernon Reed may have done lead guitar.
I remember I always think about Porno Graffiti, and I think about the people that heard More Than Words or Wholehearted, and oh, this is a nice band, and they
and then
put on Little Susie Wants What or what. I mean, it's like I like Extreme.
That's a Boston band too, and I'm giving credit to a Boston band.
I like Extreme, and I saw them in concert, and they put on a great show. The album afterwards,
and that was the last one they did. Three Sides.
There's a song on there called Tragic Comic, which is a crime that song wasn't a huge hit. But like we mentioned with Badlands, timing. But you know, you say that Nuno Bettencourt, you know, didn't become a superstar. Yeah, he did when he's playing guitar for Rihanna.
Yeah,
he made more money with her than he ever did with Extreme, and that's with two number one hits.
Yeah,
that's amazing how much money that woman brings in.
But yeah, you know. And you're going to see a couple of these guys up here that disappeared for a while and came back. But they left a lasting impression on me when they were doing what they did at first.
Extreme's a great band. They're like, I mean, I almost compared them to like, I don't know how to say. I mean, Gary Cherone reminded me a lot of Mick Jagger. Like they were that kind of show. It was in a club. Oh, okay. It was in a theater.
Live version, yeah.
It was in a theater, but the show was like a Stone show, small scale. It was great.
All right.
Nuno is a real special guitar player. He's got a very, very unique style. I remember back in the day, one of my favorite cover bands used to do a cover version of Get the Funk Out.
Yeah.
And I remember the guitar player from that band. Used to nail the guitar solo. I'd be so jealous, like, wow, you could. I mean, it was just phenomenal, you know. And he's got such a unique style. I wasn't a huge Extreme fan, but I did like him a lot. His playing is just it's a clinic. You listen to any other CDs you listen to, it's a guitar clinic. The guy can just, he's scary good. He's like scary good.
And he is what you call a handsome man.
Yeah, he is.
He's not a bad looking guy.
You could call him a handsome man.
I remember I saw Nuno after Extreme. He did a solo album, and when I remember, I must have had a good time. It was a club.
In other words, yeah,
I must have had a good time. You know why? I smoked two packs of cigarettes. That's how much fun I was having that night.
Yikes!
Yeah, I was drinking quite a bit. In the 20s, I miss them.
Yeah.
All right. Number 7 for Mr. Decker.
Man. I have just notes here. All right.
That's fine.
I'm going to go with this guy. So I saw this guy play. I was probably 19, 20 years old. Saw him play in concert in Bethlehem, PA. Never saw anybody play guitar like this guy ever before. Almost like the guitar was a part of his, it was effortless. I've never seen anyone play and make it look so easy. You know, just like he was born with it in his hands. It was part of him. His expressions, you know, everything about him was just incredible. Not a big style of this kind of music, but I love the way this guy plays, and that was Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Oh yeah,
just incredible. You know, another guy taken, you know, way too soon, and it's awful because I saw him play that concert, and then he was coming around to another theater in Wilkes-Barre, PA, a couple of years after that. And that was my own backyard, you know, and a good friend of mine who had gone to the first show with invited me to go. And I forget the circumstance, but I didn't go, thinking, oh, I'll catch him next time. I'll catch him next time, you know. Yeah. And then he died. And, you know, there was no next time. But I saw it one time. And the most memorable thing about that concert I did see was, I don't know much about his past, but I guess he went through some addiction issues and this and that, maybe some alcohol, drug issues, things like that.
Big time.
And there was one point in the concert where, like, it got real. He brought the band down, and for lack of a better word, like a disco ball in the center of the stage, and the whole stadium went dark, and just that ball was spinning. He was playing this really, really mellow piece of music, talking about that addiction, you know, and the things he went through and how he'd been clean for a number of years, you know. And as he's doing that, the band is building. You can feel something is coming. Something's coming. Something's coming. And then the last thing he said was, "Is everybody with me?" And the crowd went nuts. And when he said that, the band kicked into this like full-blown whatever it was. And he just let loose with this just barrage of like wall of guitar sound, and then right into Little Wing, the Hendrix cover. Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, I can picture it like it was yesterday, and the chills that went through my body. I mean, it was just phenomenal. You know, I'm not a big blues guy. Like I'm really just like a one trick pony metal guitar player, rock guitar player, but his style really resonates with me a lot. And to watch him play again, just like he wasn't even trying. Like it just flows out of them, you know, and that's pretty unique.
With a name like Stevie, it's got to be good.
There you go.
Exactly.
Stevie Ray Vaughan's, I just ignore it. Like you ignore my quips. Stevie Ray Vaughan was somebody I didn't really appreciate, mm-hmm. even though he's for like 45 minutes away from me in Austin.
Right. Right.
There's actually a memorial for him right on the water. It's pretty cool.
Oh, wow.
And, that, and he played here all the time, and it's just one thing I never got to go. I never went. It's like, right. You know, I'll see him next time. I said that about Tom Petty, and Tom Petty.
Me too about Tom Petty. And Tom Petty is probably one of the only guys that I haven't seen that I really wanted to see. And he played here in Newark, you know, before he died. I'm like, and tickets were crazy expensive. I thought, no, I'm not paying that. I'll get him next time. And then you know, he passes away. It's like, oh, damn, you know.
I remember I was at the Kiss show August 22nd, 1990.
Yeah.
It was my second Kiss show on the Hot in the Shade tour. And I remember Paul was up there with Bruce, and they were talking about, hey, we're in Texas, Bruce, you know, and stuff like that. And you know who's from Texas? Stevie Ray Vaughan. And Bruce started playing some Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Get out.
3 days later, he was killed.
Oh, my God.
Because I remember I was in high school my senior year, and we heard on the radio that Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Was it a plane crash?
Yeah, it was a helicopter.
Yeah.
Plane crash or helicopter?
But
he's got a song that's probably one of my favorites, and when I'm kind of going through some tough times, and it may be the song he was playing, Stevie, Joe.
Yeah.
Life by the Drop. I don't know if that was it.
Okay.
Because that's about addiction and about like life by the drop. You're living each day. Don't have that drop or whatever. It's that may be it.
But okay.
That's just a beautiful, beautiful song.
It might have been that. It really was. I'll never forget the way that the crowd just reacted to his testimony there, you know, in front of 10,000 people. And it was just a beautiful, he set the ambiance perfectly, you know, then just right into that little wing, like, wow, this was just like so special, you know, incredible.
You know, he plays on the David Bowie album, Let's Dance, right?
Yes. Yes. Okay. I did know that.
A lot of people didn't know that.
Yep.
I didn't know that.
Yep.
Yep.
Good job, Worden.
He's from Texas, man. What do you expect? We're a cult. We stick together.
All right. Number 7 for you, Worden.
All right. This may surprise both of y'all because he'll probably be higher on y'all's list. Oh, God. Ack!
I knew it.
Okay.
Honestly, Ace almost didn't make my list because there's a couple more that I would have put in his place. Mm-hmm. And I remember who my favorite band is and you know, and how much, I mean, it's like, I'm not the biggest Ace fan. Y'all know that. Except for Torpedo Girl, which I love. And Steve never lets me forget. But Ace is great. Like I said, I got into Kiss a little bit later than the Ace era. I always thought it was good, but I kind of look at Ace kind of like Gene said it once, and I may get flack for this, but it's like, I don't know. I think he was a little lazy.
You think?
And I think that he could have been a bigger star. Of course, he's not, you know, the money grubbing guy that Gene is. I get that. But I thought he could have been capable of so much more. And I just think about how great Kiss would have been if he would have stayed in the 80s. Because I love his 80s stuff when he got clean. I mean, can you imagine Paul singing, you know, Into the Night? I mean, Ace is good, but with a voice like Paul in the 80s, I mean, I just think if he would have stayed the line, but honestly, I know being in Kiss would have killed him. I agree with that because he was out of control. But I look at Ace and, you know, for the early years, but I was always, there's what could have been with him. I just,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
But I mean, I don't have to cut the guy down. We all have our demons, you know, but
yeah.
But, you know, he's not in my top whatever. Probably like, he's probably higher on y'all's list.
Yeah. Definitely.
I think a big thing with hit really a point where I think Ace, you know, other than the addictions he had and the problems he had, I think he became complacent. You know, it seemed to me, and Peter as well, it seemed to me that, you know, Paul and Gene, they were constantly honing their craft. You know, Paul's vocals just got better and better. I mean, his wheelhouse between like 77 to like maybe the early 90s, his voice was ungodly,
and there was nobody that sounded like him.
No, he was so distinct, and you know, and Gene doesn't get enough credit for his bass playing. He's a solid bass player.
Definitely.
He really, really is, and a really good singer too. And you can tell those guys, they got better. You know, where Ace, I think he got to the point where it's like, you know what, I'm good enough. I'm Ace Frehley. I'm Ace Frehley. You know, I'm making a lot of money. I'm going to drink, I'm going to do my thing, and I'm making millions of dollars, and this is what I'm going to be. And he couldn't keep up, you know, he couldn't have played on those 80s albums because he wasn't that guitar player. Like in the 80s, when guitar players got good, when you got the Randy Rhoadses and the George Lynch and the Jakey Lees, you know, Ace's style was different, but you couldn't suck. You know, that's why I think Bruce is a perfect fit for those albums, because Bruce was that guy. He could show with the best of them. I'll talk more about Ace later on, but I'm with you. I mean,
shocking.
I love him.
Shock me
for a lot of reasons, but I am kind of saddened by where I saw him go. You know, and even now I can't now.
I think Ace's biggest success was also his biggest misstep was his solo album, because it was so good.
Yeah.
And I think he believed that hype. But when Rock Soldiers came out, I mean, it wasn't huge, like, because he wasn't with Kiss. Right. I think the Kiss logo, I think the Kiss name was bigger than the four individuals. Ace is just so more because he's a guitar player.
Yeah.
But I mean, when he did it solo, I think they were better, like the reunion tour poured it, the original members together.
Yeah.
And maybe the reunion tour wouldn't have been as much if he would have stayed in the band, but I don't know. I mean, you say that about, you know, all those bands, but you know, there's bands like Joe Perry that, you know, they weren't, you know, like the fast guys. They stayed the line and kind of did it. Kiss could have went in that direction, the older direction, I think, with Ace, if Ace just would have got his stuff together, but we'll never know.
Nope.
Yeah.
All right. Number seven for me.
Taylor Swift.
No. Tommy. No. It's another guy that in the line, and we may see all three of these guys, the three main ones out of this. Another in the line of the guitarist from that solo artist. And nobody knew who he was before No Rest for the Wicked came along, but Zach Wilde. And man, when No Rest for the Wicked came out, and I'm sitting here, you know, because you get all the hype and Hit Parade about, you know, Jakey Lee's gone. They've got this new guy coming in, this hot shot. And you look at him back then, long blonde hair.
He had some good hair, man. He had some good hair.
A rail and wearing all this crazy stuff. And then look at him now. He's a freaking beast, and he's a biker looking dude. But let me tell you,
Innard, brother.
No Rest for the Wicked came out. That guy, I was like, yeah, Ozzy's going to be fine. That guy can flat out play. Yeah.
And he was 19 years old.
Yes.
19 years old.
And Ozzy was already 45, wasn't he?
At least. I mean,
not older. But yeah, No Rest for the Wicked just pretty much did it. And then No More Tears. When More Tears came out, you saw how much better he had got in that short time. In just, 3 years, he was at the top of his game.
Yeah.
Mama, I'm Coming Home. All of those great songs from No More Tears, he just killed it on. Then he goes on Pride and Glory, Black Label Society, Zach Sabbath, you know, and still
Pantera's doing coming up. You're going to be in Pantera coming
get
up.
Get ready to do the Pantera tour.
I'll go see that because I'm a big Pantera fan.
But the fact that he's doing something right, because the fact that he still is associated with Ozzy, and Sharon must love him because I think he does try to take care of Ozzy.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. It seems to be a great guy, but man, I heard look back at No Rest for the Wicked, and that's what got me started to be a Zach Wilde fan. And
I remember when, of course I was already into Ozzy because of, you know, I had just gotten Bark of the Moon. And then did Bark of the Moon come before Ultimate Sin?
Yeah.
Because I probably skipped Ultimate Sin and probably, but I got to it later. But I remember Crazy Babies. I saw it on MTV.
Crazy Babies, yes.
And I remember it was Ozzy and Zach, and it was like Christmas or something. And Ozzy was like in some guy, and they were both just blitzed. And I remember seeing Crazy Babies.
Oh, okay.
On a Headbanger's Ball or something.
Yeah, Headbanger's
Ball. And I go, I got to get that single. I bought the CD, the cassette single back in the day. I remember buying that and Blow My Fuse by Kix the same day. That's what a great year of music it was. Kix. Remember Kix?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And I remember the single had the solo edited down. And I was like, what? That's not what was on MTV?
That pissed me off.
So I went out and bought the album.
Yeah. That right there. You know, there's edited songs like one of the
No More Tears. No More Tears is like that.
Yeah,
A lot of his solo.
One of the Vinnie Vincent Invasion songs, Love Kills. They've got an edited down version of it, and it totally takes away from the whole song. Why they do that?
Is that the greatest ballad ever written, Stevie? Is that the one that he was saying?
No, that's That Time of Year.
That Time of Year.
Yeah. That Time of Year is a great one now.
It's not the greatest ballad of the 80s, though.
I won't say it's not the greatest.
I think it's one of the best. Yeah, but Zach's got a really interesting style. I mean, you hear that guitar, those pick harmonics he lays down on, and you know, his use of the wah-wah pedal is just like ungodly. Yeah. And I'm with you. When he was the first video, was it for Miracle Man?
Miracle Man.
Where he's in a He takes the mask off, his Jimmy Swaggart mask off in the church.
That was the first video. I remember thinking, what's this guy's face look like? So all you saw was hair flying back and forth through the hole. You never saw his face, you know?
That was how he was in Mom, I'm Coming Home, too. All he did over there was just...
Damn, like, who is this dude? And he's from here. He's from New Jersey. I think he's from Red Bank, which isn't too far from me here. I think you're right, but in Taking Care of Ozzy, I remember seeing an interview with Zach, and he was like being interviewed by an interview person, and in the background behind him, Ozzy was sitting there like in another room where you could see Ozzy on the camera, you know, but the guy's talking to Zach. Ozzy goes to lean back in a chair, and the whole chair falls over, and just boom, Ozzy's down on his back, you know, and Zach turns and looks, he goes, "This shit never ends." And he just gets up and he goes,
"Wasn't that on the Osbournes?"
Yeah. One of us, the Osbournes, and he goes over.
I do remember because they're in like a trailer. I think they're shooting a video or
That's
something.
Funny.
They're in a trailer, like, and you look in the background, you see Ozzy go over.
He goes down, and it's just the funniest freaking thing, you know. And he just walks over, helps him up. And it's like, man, but I guess he must have Sharon's blessing because he's been the longest guitar player.
Definitely, by far.
And you're right. To look at him now is not that 19-year-old kid that joined that band, you know,
he's on the Sons of Anarchy or something.
Exactly. Yeah. He looks like a big badass. And I like his stuff with Black Label. He seems like a real genuine, cool, like not an asshole kind of a guy either. Like he probably like just a good conversation, you know.
Yeah.
Like a lot of these guys we meet, you know, our heroes, and they turn out to be just jerks, which I'll get to one of those guys later on. But you know, I don't think Zach's one of them. Yeah, I think Zach's a pretty cool dude. Yeah.
Yep. Cool. So Zach Wild.
Good pick, Stevie. I approve.
Number seven for me.
Yeah.
Number six for Mr. Decker.
Again, people might think that he should be higher on the list just because of who he is and everything and what he did for guitar. But Eddie Van Halen, you know, I'm not a huge Van Halen fan. I was never a huge Van Halen fan. If I was, I probably preferred the Sammy Hagar Van Halen stuff than the Dave stuff. You know, the Dave stuff was more fun party rock. The Sammy stuff was more music stuff, you know. But through it all, Eddie's guitar playing, I can't say enough about it. I mean, you know, he influenced so many people, people that I was influenced by who probably would have, you know, got a guitar had they not heard him, you know. And he's one of those guys where you just, like, you know, everyone loved him. Everyone just loved who he was. Yeah. I'm kind of speechless because there's so much to say about him. I don't even know where even to start, you know, and it's sad that he's gone, but just a phenomenal talent and just so many. I mean, I could just go on and on and on with song after song after song after song. And his death really hit me hard because he was the first guy, I think, kind of from you know, that era for me that, you know, other than I was too young when Randy died, you know, Randy, I was 12, you know, and even with Stevie, but Eddie Van Halen, he wasn't supposed to die. He was supposed to be playing, you know, into his 70s, 80s, you know, years old, and he'd still be playing around. And that was really, really sad. That's all I'm kind of a little bit tongue tied with even talking about him, you know?
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah,
we'll talk a little bit about him later on.
Yeah, there's Eddie Trunk talks about how he put something on Twitter, and I'm not the biggest Eddie Trunk fan, but he talked about how there's no tributes to him like there are to Taylor or you know well-deserved tributes. And I think Wolfie got on there and like called Eddie out, and Eddie didn't say anything about him, saying, "Well, I don't know what you expect me to do," and I'm like, Eddie didn't single you out, brother. There's other people besides you that can do this.
Yeah.
And I just thought that, like, wow, that you're really the brat that they say you are sometimes, Wolfie. And it's like, it sucks. Like, it's like Eddie said, there's no box sets out for Van Halen. I mean, there's so much probably stuff he hasn't released.
Oh yeah. They were talking about that.
Yeah. And it's a shame because a whole new generation could discover him like they're doing with Prince now with, you know, his stuff coming out. The stuff he didn't want to come out, but his family didn't have a will, so that's what happened. So I'll be talking about him later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll be talking a little bit more about him later. Number six for you, Ward.
A lot of people are going to say it's blasphemy. I put this guy this high above the guy I just mentioned.
Oh,
but he's my favorite guitar player from Kiss. He was in the band when I got into the band in the Asylum era. Probably out of all the, maybe next to Eric Singer, he's the only probably guy I would like to meet, because Gene and Paul, it seems like there's a day you got to get them on a good day. This guy, hey guys. I mean, it's like they say on Shout Out Loudcast. Hey,
Bruce Kulick.
I just love Bruce Kulick. I think Bruce Kulick is very underrated. I think that he was in an era where he wasn't. I mean, can you imagine he's as old as Ace is, if he would have been in the band originally? Mm-hmm. I don't know if his style would have made in the 70s. He played with Bolton and stuff, but
Blackjack.
Yeah, Blackjack. I mean, but Bruce Kulick, I mean, the guy I'd like to meet. I mean, I think you can have a beer with him and talk about old times, but I remember getting my first Kiss concert visual was Animalize, which I think, you know, a lot of us that got in the 80s, and he was the guitarist in Kiss. You know, when I saw Kiss and I got into him, I know those two guys were an Ace and Peter. I'm not, you know, with the makeup.
Yeah.
But I always, the non-makeup era is my era. That's what I grew up in. But Bruce Kulick.
And I'm going to go ahead and tell you, my number six, Bruce Kulick.
Wow.
Oh, my God. It's raining, Stevie.
So, I mean, it's, yeah. I'm like I like to call him, the ambassador of Kiss. I mean, the nicest guy you'll ever, I've never met him, but just seems like the nicest guy you'd probably ever want to meet in Kiss. Doesn't have any ego, but goes out there and plays. I remember, you know, seeing in like the circus magazines and the hip paraders back when he wasn't an official member. He was playing on the tour because of what was going on with Mark St. John. But you would just like, every time you would hear something more about it with Bruce Kulick still playing, you're like, why don't they just make him a member of the band?
Right.
Just do it. Go ahead and do it. I mean, it's not going to get any better. And
his hand ain't swelling up.
Exactly. You just need to go ahead and do it. And when they finally did it, man, geez, up until Tommy Thayer, really, when you go back and look at, everybody says, well, Tommy Thayer's been in the band longer than any guitar player, but Bruce put out more, I think, as far as a guitar player, put out more than, a lot more than Tommy did. I'm not sure about Ace. A lot better, too. I'm not sure if he put out more than Ace, because they were putting out stuff regularly then. So they put out
Asylum, Crazy Nights, Hot in the Shade, Revenge, Carnival of Souls, five.
Five. I think Ace put out more. Because you had the Kiss.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Tommy Thayer and how many long.
Oh, no, I know he put out more than Tommy Thayer.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, that by all means he put out, but yeah, and he's not my favorite guitar player in Kiss, but he's right there with him, man. I mean, the guy can flat out play, and I didn't ever get to me the whole thing where on one of the home videos, I forget which one it was, where Paul talks about, he looked like a tree, you know.
That was Gene.
Well, yeah, whoever it was, he didn't get. I mean, the guy's a freaking entertainer. He was moving around like, he wasn't doing freaking cartwheels and jumping jacks like Paul used to do on the
Asylum. That's why he had to get a hip replacement.
Exactly. But
did you ever? I think the scariest thing about Bruce was like those pants he had that had like the leopard, the animal print on. Like they weren't the whole pants, but they were like the top of his boots or something. I'm like, what the hell is that?
But yeah, I mean, but Bruce, you know, you see now Grand Funk Railroad, and then he got the Bruce Kulick band, which is such a freaking awesome band. He can still play his butt off.
But I ask you guys a question, your opinion. You know how the originals, fans of the original, the Ace Cult or whatever, that they like to go after Thayer and they like to go after Eric Singer.
They don't touch Bruce or Eric.
Corey. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Do you think it's because of social media? They didn't have social media in the 80s. Don't you think that they would have been attacked maybe if we had social media in the 80s?
Yeah, I think they would have been.
I think so, too. They don't get touched because that was a different era.
I think the difference with Tommy and Bruce, though, is
the makeup.
The makeup. Bruce is his own guy. He's not. I mean, that's the big joke, like that these guys are playing in a cover band. You know, Bruce – was playing stuff that he wrote, that he recorded, where Tommy's just pretty much laying down, you know, 85% of the set, probably, well, 95%. Did they do any songs off of Monster at all, or Sonic Boom at all in these shows anymore?
Hey, yeah.
Oh, so they got one song that he actually recorded, but I think that's a lot of it. You know, sadly, by the time Bruce was in the band, you know, I'd kind of left Kiss. I think after I kind of departed from Kiss probably around Dynasty. You know, I'd heard the hits, The Heaven's on Fire, It's Not Bruce, and, you know, Tears Are Falling, and all. I saw the videos because they were on constant rotation, but I didn't hear any songs off those albums besides the hits that were on the radio or on MTV. Sadly, you know, I just started revisiting those albums since listening actually to the, you know, to Tom and Zeus when they did the reviews. I listened along with it. I'm thinking, I missed all this stuff. Like, I'd never heard Heart of Chrome and you know, all these great songs that are on these albums. I never heard, it was like hearing for the first time. You know, Bruce was the perfect guitar player for that era. And like you said, nice guy. Sadly, when were those conventions, those Kiss conventions, back in the early 90s, maybe?
Yeah, 95.
Around that time, I went to one here in New Jersey. And
I remember you telling me this.
Oh, yeah, you told us the story. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was such an Ace Cult guy even then, because I'd never heard the cool stuff that Bruce played on. And he's at this convention, and I bump into him, and I just, he's super tall, first of all. I couldn't know how tall he was, you know. And he's like, "Hey, how are you?" And I totally shunned the man because I'm like, "You're not Ace. I don't want to talk, you know. I don't even want to talk to you, you know." And now I think, what an asshole I was. You know, I could have had a conversation with this guy. And yeah, but no, I'm with you. I think he's great. I think
God, I can imagine if you met Tommy with the Ace makeup on, man, you really would have flipped your lid.
You really would. You gotta be in jail right now.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. And yeah, he's great. He's an awesome guitar player. Seems like such a great human being. And you know, there's no surprise to me why when he plays with his solo band and does all those awesome deep tracks, that the crowd just goes crazy for him. It's no surprise. He's probably the biggest thing on the Kiss cruise, is, you know, even bigger than maybe even Kiss, and definitely the biggest thing at, like, you know, the Creatures Fest type stuff like that. You know, everyone's there to see him, you know.
I think Kiss missed the mark, but I don't think they could afford to by not having him open up for them, because I think they may have outshined them on the concert. Yeah. And
they don't want to have to follow.
No, I know. I agree with you. But if they were as confident as they say they are, they would have had him and the rest and other members on there.
No, that's why they got some guy painting pictures, because they, you know, that's
three times I've seen this tour. All three times.
Their egos can't take it. I mean, to put a band like Bruce's band on that stage with those younger guys and that much energy and doing the songs that we want to hear, you know.
You're right.
Anything after that would just be a bore fest, you know.
Yep. I agree.
Yeah,
I'm with you. Okay, I'm going home. I heard all night later.
Yeah,
number five for Mr. Decker. We're in the top five now.
Number five. Gosh, it's really getting down to it now. All right, I'm going to go with this guy, and I don't think you guys will have a hard time with this one at all. Of the three guitar players in this band, well, I guess technically four. Definitely my favorite, Don Felder. Gee,
I'm about to say, who could that be with four guitar players?
Yeah, we talked about this a little bit when we did the Eagles countdown. This guy just has a style and a knack for just like
pissing people off. Yeah,
pissing people off,
Mr. Felder.
Yeah, right.
Mr. Felder. That's so funny to me how they talk about him. Like,
yeah, I know.
Since we did that show, I watched that documentary again, that 4-hour thing. I had to watch
it. Yeah, great.
I sat there just like,
Mr.
I cracked up, you know.
I think it's about forgiveness, Don Henley would sing.
Yeah.
But it's really not. It's really not about that at all.
It's about money.
Yeah. How much is enough, you know? Come on.
I don't know. It's never enough, but... This guy, he's definitely my favorite guy. When I listen to the old Eagles albums, I like his solos the best. I like his sound the best. And he's got that perfect combination. I mentioned a little bit on that Eagles show, you know, about how these certain guitar players, they just have a way of like having like they'll play something, then there's a response, and play something, there's a response. And it's often they'll play the same phrase, then play it again, but change one note. And he does that brilliantly. If you listen to his work, he'll play one phrase and play the exact same thing, but like one note different. It's like a call and response. And a musician friend years ago told me that's how you should craft your music. Some of us have told him as well, because he does it all the time and does it masterfully. So he's my number five.
And he, like Gilmore, he's like up in the 80s. He's close to 80, and he can still play.
Yeah.
Yeah, I read I'm a big Don Felder fan, of course. But I read his book, and his book was awesome.
That was a great book.
That was a great book. He didn't hold back,
he shouldn't have either.
You kind of see his side. That what freaked me out is when he was talking about how he was looking for some blow, and he went to the bat. It was like he went out to, I guess, to get blow, and somebody like, I'll get some, and he got it before, and the guy, he got the blow. It was with Ajax. It was laced with Ajax, I guess.
Oh yeah.
Like what they did in Cheech and Chong, and the guy came out bleeding, and that was one of his biggest wake up calls, I guess.
So,
you know, it couldn't have been easy for him. I think any guitar player duo you see, you know, when those got popular, think about when those started, like, you know, the Judas Priest and the Iron Maidens, you know, that was way before there, it, you know, to play with Joe Walsh probably wasn't easy to begin with because Joe was kind of a maniac.
Yeah.
But those two had a real, their styles were so different, but yet so wonderful together, you know. I mean, it doesn't get any more iconic than that. We talked about a lot, the Hotel California, you know, outro harmony solo. It's just like, it's amazing. So I really appreciate his discipline. It's not easy playing with two guitar players in a band, much less three. You know, it's easy to step on toes that way. And for these guys to pull that off the way that they did for all those years where, you know, egos were set aside, let's play for the song. That says a lot about it, I think, as far as them crafting music together.
Yeah. I remember that in his book, he was saying that he couldn't remember how many times he drove Joe to rehab and got him straight.
Oh.
But when it came between when, I guess, Henley and Fry cut him off, he just cut him off like, jeez, friendship's gone. I mean, that's who you find your friends are. I mean, Joe Walsh has enough money. I mean, come on. Yeah. The guy saved his life, and he just, I mean, like you said, money.
Yep.
But Felder is 75. I just looked that up.
Yeah, he's up there.
He's that old?
Wow. Yes. We're not any spring chickens anymore.
it's just sometimes it blows my mind because I still
it
feel
does
like
me
19,
too.
You know, and these guys are it's incredible.
And what gets me is when I see like a younger person, I'm thinking like, oh, you know, and you're thinking of them older, like, no, like I was watching Albert Pujols this whole hit his home runs, and I was like, yeah, he's getting old. I'm like, shit, dude, you're like 8 years older than him. You kind of don't think that way, like kind of with musicians too.
Yep. All right, number five for you, Ward.
Number five was just mentioned by Joe, one of my early favorites. I'm a Sammy Hagar era guy. I actually like David Lee Roth solo more than I do the stuff in Van Halen, and I know that's blasphemy to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
But Eddie Van Halen, I remember the first video I saw and when I discovered Van Halen was Jump. I was late to the party. And I just remember this guy, you know, you had this blonde maniac, you know, jumping around and stuff. Then you had this guitar player so happy, just smiling all the time. I didn't realize he was high or drunk or whatever. It's like, man, he's really a happy guy.
Yeah.
But I mean, Jump, game changer. I mean, the keyboards, I know that. You know, I tell my older friends that you're such a metalhead and you got into, it's like, I mean, I was 12 years old. I mean, and 1994 was my first, I still love that album. I'm a keyboard guy. I don't mind them. You know, David Lee Roth obviously was okay with him when he went solo, but yeah, all I got notes here is there's no doubt what he meant to hard rock and metal. And people still talk about that. I hear people, oh, look at Ace in 1970. Oh, no, he was tapping there. You know, they still talk about the tap. That's what he did. And it's amazing all these years people playing guitar, and he's the one, still something new that came up as recent was. But I just wish we had some box sets. I wish we had more, you know, I don't want anything live with David, but, you know, something, you know, There's got to be a bunch of, there's got to be vaults and stuff out there. I just wish we had it.
Gone too soon. It is. And it's interesting. I'm old enough to remember when 1984 came out, when that was released, and the controversy surrounding that, because, you know, Eddie Van Halen's a guitar player, not a keyboard player. You know,
that was a big thing.
And, you know, and Jump was such a stretch from, I think the album before that was Diver Down. Diver Down. And then before that was Fair Warning. And Fair Warning was like, that's a guitar clinic. That is just like
Unchained, boom. Right? Was it Unchained on that one?
Unchained, Mean Street.
Yeah.
That song is like one of my, that might be my favorite Van Halen song ever. And so 84 comes out, and there's this video Jump, and it's just like, there's Eddie on keyboards. And I just remember the reviews were so mixed between, and I wasn't a big fan of that song. I did like I liked Al Wait a lot better than that one. I love Panama. It was a great song.
Drop Dead Legs, Top Jimmy.
The Jump song, and that was on such heavy rotation at MTV at the time. I mean, you could not turn that on. I mean, it was on probably once an hour. That song was on.
But they knew what they were doing, because they got kids like me to become a fan, because 5150, OU812, then on.
And after that, it became Eddie plays keyboards too. You know, then all of a sudden that just became like a staple. That's what he does. You know?
David did them too.
Yeah.
Especially
yeah.
on Eat 'em and Smile, or not Eat 'em and Smile, Skyscraper.
Yeah. Well,
all right, so number five for you, the Eddie Van Halen. Number five for me, and this is another guy that this is probably going to be the one that shocks Worden.
Glenn Campbell.
Yeah, Rhinestone Cowboy. No, this guy was, I mean, had it.
Glenn Campbell was a great guitarist, by the way.
I'm not taking anything away from that. But
it sounds like we're all doing rock. We didn't pick any country stuff.
No, I didn't pick country, but. This guy was, you know, and you talk about timing. He had his time in the late 80s, but another guy that disappeared. That you always wondered what the heck happened. This guy was self-taught. He couldn't read notes. He just played by ear. And then he had that freaking guitar I don't know what the proper term of, after I tell you who it is, Joe.
I know who it is.
You'll know who I'm talking about. Go ahead, guess.
Did he play with Alice Cooper?
No.
Okay, never mind.
No.
You knew who I'm talking about though, right?
Kane Roberts?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
No, I'm not talking about Kane Roberts.
You said his guitar. I thought he had that machine gun guitar.
No, this was okay. No. And maybe
that really would have surprised me if Kane Roberts was above Bruce Kulick.
No. This guy, you know, and you always wanted to hear that he was making a comeback. And I think he had some family issues, and then he had a injury to his wrist that has kept him from coming back. But Vito Bratta from White
Line.
I thought you liked him so much. Yeah, yeah.
Yes. I mean, this guy, you sit there and listen to Pride. Listen to the guitar solos on that and Wait. And then on the next album, Little Fighter, the guitar solo set. I was doing research, and Mike Tramp talked about it. They tried to do New White Line. And with all people, Paul Gilbert was one of them. Warren DeMartini was one of them. And none of them wanted to try to be Vito. Nobody wanted to try to play that. And what was the deal? I don't know the proper term for his, because he had a guitar that didn't, it had the nick, but it didn't have the top of it with the stuff on it. What is that? I mean,
there was that for a while, that was like a style. I think they were made by a company called Schecter, and these headless guitars were popular for a while. Yeah. I never had one. I never even actually saw one. I mean, I've seen them in a store, but never actually saw one live, how it all went together. But, I'm not sure what his deal was with that, other than the fact maybe he was big on the whammy bar.
Was that just something for a look? Or, I mean, was it for sound, was it?
I think it's more just for a look, you know. Remember those little bases were out for a while there? I think they had one. It looked like a little box almost. You know, there was
Stanley played like a body glove guitar that had no head, like on his solo tour. I remember that.
Just more for the look, but
they could show off more. They could show off more chest hair with a not such a big guitar, I guess.
maybe, you know.
But look, Yeah, talking about Vito, but you know, and it's a shame because he's. I think Mike Tramp actually
tried. He tried.
He's tried, he just can't get it. And Vito came out on an interview a few years back with Eddie Trunk and was talking about stuff, but nothing ever really came of it. But I mean, Guitar World magazine named him one of the best 20 best guitarists in the 80s, and he was there from 87. I think Pride came out in 87. So, yeah, while he
Main Attraction was pretty good too.
I told you, Steve, about Fight to Survive. That's you like that. That's a
yes.
I found those guys, you know, back in the day, used to go to the record store and look through the imports. And if the cover looked cool, you'd buy it. And sometimes you get lucky, you know. Sometimes you get White Lion, sometimes you get Grim Reaper, and you're like, ah, shit, you know,
Grim Reaper.
If you're going by the covers, you know. And that's where I found them. And he's a phenomenal guitar player, very unique style.
Yeah.
He's big on the tapping. I hear a lot of Eddie in him. I'm sure he's very, very influenced by Eddie.
And
I loved his tone. He had a really cool, crunchy, crunchy tone. After we talked about him not too long ago, I went to Spotify and found some live stuff. His live playing was just amazing. I mean, it's perfect, you know.
Yeah. It's just a shame we didn't hear more of him. And I don't know. I mean, how old is he? Let me see how old he is now.
Oh, Vito's got to be. These guys, he probably isn't. He's probably in his
60s. 61.
Yeah.
Because you think about those guys, I mean, they were already in their like late 20s in the 80s. So,
yeah.
Right.
It said Mike Tramp tried to reunite with 2003. Unsuccessful, and then he talked about him in a 2007 interview, claiming he was always quiet and maintained a certain distance from the rest of the band. And 2007, when he gave his first live interview in over 12 years on Eddie Trunk, and talked about his father, and it was hard for him with his wrist to move his hand up and down the electric guitar's neck, but he could still play classical guitar, but he just couldn't. Yeah, I mean,
I don't know. I think with a lot of these guys, it's kind of like Robert Plant. You know, you're not who you used to be. Yeah. So, yeah, you can offer me $1 billion, but I'm not Robert Plant from 77, you know.
I mean, look.
He probably feels that way, too.
If people would pay all this money to see Vinnie Vincent play again after all this time, then daggum, people should pay a lot of money to see
Vinnie. But maybe he can't play like he said with that wrist.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's got to be it. But, you know.
He's probably more hurt than he lets on, man. That's probably a big reason.
And that's what I'm thinking too. I hope so. But I mean, mad respect for Vito Brada. Absolutely. My top five.
I saw who's the singer? Mike Tramp.
Mike Tramp, yeah.
I saw him. He cut all his hair off and he's all tatted up. And I was like, damn, dude.
He does not look like Mike Tramp.
I know. Today. Still a handsome man. But he does. He's all tatted up now.
Look, Mike Tramp was a handsome man.
He was a handsome man.
Yes. So. Yeah, we're probably gonna make Tom and Zeus mad.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
He got a little bit whiny though. I liked his voice, but like that, I wasn't a fan of like that Children Cry song.
Yeah, I'm with you, brother. I hate that song. I can't stand that song.
Wait, tell me.
A good song. Their cover of Radar Love's awesome.
Radar Love, Vito.
Vito,
look, I could go through the whole Pride. Song. You could play, and I've, you know, y'all.
And I like some stuff off Main Attraction. I could play the whole Pride album.
The whole Pride album from start to finish and not have a problem.
Love Takes Time, or what was the single? Love Don't Come Easy.
Love Don't Come Easy. I think that's what it was.
Yeah. I think I played that
Mariah Carey.
That Pride cassette I played.
That's next week's summer? Podcast.
My God. Mariah Carey?
Yeah. No.
We're gonna do a top 20 and make Katie suffer.
But Pride, you know, I probably wore that cassette out.
I know I did.
And you can hear his guitar like in the Weight when he kicks in.
Dude, that is awesome.
They get crap for being a glam band, but that's heavy as hell. That's heavy. Awesome.
Let me tell you this. If they're gonna give them crap for being a glam band, then give me crap for liking them because I loved White Line.
Well, it's like Jericho kind of rags on him. He's the biggest hair guy there is, but he was saying they were opening him for AC/DC. Probably not a good fit.
That was not the good fit.
They would open good for Kiss. They would have been a good. I think they opened up for
Kiss. My brother actually went to see that tour, the AC/DC, and I was like, "All right, who's opening up for him?" He was like, "Oh, I think it's White Line." I was like, "Really?" And I was like, they probably get batteries thrown at them or something like that.
Do you remember those? Do you remember those days to where like you kind of got like, oh, that's White Lion. Oh, Lion? No. And there was another band called Lion.
Yeah.
The band, but no, like, you had White
Mark
Tiger.
White Tiger.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So number four for Joe.
Number four. Okay. Number four. There was two guys and their styles are so similar. I had a hard time deciding on the two. And I know that these guys are actually friends. The guy I didn't pick is Warren DeMartini. I love Warren. I love him. Love him, love him, love him. Think he's phenomenal. I was a big Rat fan back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
But the guy that I decided to go with is George Lynch.
Oh, wow. I thought you were going to go with Robin Crosby for a second.
He's going with Robin Crosby.
I was like, yeah, that's what I thought. Oh, wow.
No. When you listen to Warren and listen to George, their styles are very, very similar in how they play. But the reason I picked George Lynch is because George Lynch goes into more of the darker notes that Warren doesn't. And I like that. I like the fact that he's self-taught. He doesn't really know what he's doing. He'll even say, I don't even know why what I play works. I mean, when you learn how to play some of his songs, the scales that he chose to use, I don't even know where he found these notes. They shouldn't work. Theoretically, they don't work, but they do for him. He, though, is one of those guys that when I saw live did not really stay true to his recorded stuff. And I found out why later on in hearing interviews from him. What they used to let him do is just let him play. He just play and play and play and play and play. Then a producer would take pieces of the solos and kind of that he liked and piece the thing together say, here's your solo. He had to go back and kind of like almost like relearn it. I mean, he just learn how it went from beginning to end. So when you saw him live, he really didn't know. And now I would swear the man forgot how to play a guitar. If you follow his Instagram, he's terrible. I mean, it's really it's tough to watch.
You like watching Stevie play, huh?
Me too. I can't really watch him anymore. He still plays. I mean, I haven't seen him live for a long time. And
as a guitar player, what do you mean by that? I mean,
how he plays?
Yeah. I mean, what do you mean he's terrible? I mean, would a non-musician say that too?
I think so.
Really?
I think if you went on his Instagram and watched his Instagram stuff, you'd be like, what is this guy doing?
Too many steroids, or remember he got all buff?
And I remember when he got all buff.
Oh, yeah.
He is probably one of the biggest jerks
I've heard that.
Who I've ever met in my life. I met him at a Dawkins show at a small club in Scranton, PA when they were long done. I mean, they were lucky. I mean,
that recently or what?
No. maybe 94, 95, 96, somewhere around there, you know, the place may be held at the most a couple hundred people. Met the band afterwards and he was incredibly arrogant. You know, the other guys were super cool. Jeff Pilson, even Don Dawkins was obnoxious, but he was funny, but he was at least cordial and hung around. Mick Brown was cool. He was funny. George. And what a disappointment, because he was like my guy growing up. Like I tried to emulate his style more than probably any other guitar player in that time. I just, for some reason, his style really resonated with me and I found it easier to play his stuff than I did other guys. And to meet him and just be like, it's like, oh, you're an ass. You know, he just was just not cool at all.
Never meet your heroes, they say.
Yeah. And it's true, but his playing is undeniable. The man can turn a guitar inside out, you know, when he wants to. So
there's a song. It's probably my favorite Lynch Mob song called All I Want. It's off Wicked Sensation.
I know it. Yep.
And there's a guitar in there where he makes the guitar sound like a piano. I don't know if that's a piano. Somebody told me that's a guitar during that.
I have to listen to it again, but
the solo, he does a part in there where it sounds like a piano. My buddy was like, that's the guitar. He was doing that, the guitar. And I'm not a musician. It sounds like a damn piano, but he says the guitar. It's the solo.
Okay.
But I'll give one thing of George Lynch. I know why he hates Don Dawkins. I saw Dawkins, it wasn't George Lynch, open up for, it was Ace, Graham Bonnet, and LA Guns. and Dokken. Mm-hmm. And everybody was talking about how bad Dokken sound. I thought he was okay. It was fine. He did the hits.
Right.
But man, the guitar player he had with, he just constantly just was on his ass about everything. Oh, you think you could play faster with this? I mean, I don't know if he was joking, but I can see why he hates Don Dokken.
You remember who the guitar player was?
It was a few years ago. It was
it Red Beach?
Red Beach.
No, it wasn't Red Beach because didn't he with Whitesnake?
Yeah,
he is now, yeah, but
yeah,
he
played, no, this is
Dokken some too.
This is about 3 years ago. It wasn't Red Beach. I would remember Red Beach
from Winger.
Yeah, but he had, I just was like, no wonder George Lynch hates that guy.
Well, they're both yeah. jerks. Ego. So they both, you know,
they got egos.
But you're playing a club with 100 people. You shouldn't have too many egos.
Yeah,
but I remember. I think I told you the story, Steve. Years ago, a band I played with were managed by the same person. And the bigger band, actually the band that used to do the Extreme cover, for a while there, they got the drummer from Twisted Sister to play with them, AJ Perro.
Yeah, Perro, yeah.
And I got to know AJ pretty well. AJ was a super cool guy, very, very nice guy. It's a shame he's gone now too. Hmm. But he was a guy, he had tons and tons of stories from the road because, you know, he was where we all wanted to be. He toured the big arenas. He'd seen everything. And he said the two biggest jerks he ever met in the business, he said, the singer from Black and Blue, Jamie Saint, whatever his name really? Was.
James St. James, I think.
Yeah, and George Lynch. And George Lynch. And he said one time they were playing somewhere, like an open-air concert someplace, and you know, it's still early in the morning and they're all on their tour buses sleeping and someone's on the stage just playing the guitar obnoxiously loud. And he went out there, and it was George, and he basically almost just beat the shit out of him. Just like, listen, you know, we're trying to sleep and you're out here.
Yeah, I remember you telling me this.
Wow.
And at the time that was hard to hear because I hadn't met him yet. I hadn't had the jerk experience yet. And I still loved George at that point in time. So it was kind of hard to hear, like, oh damn, he's that much of an ass, you know, but, I believe it. I totally believe it.
Me too.
Yeah.
Yeah. George Lynch, number four. And his Dokken stuff was definitely better than Lynch Mob. Yeah.
I agree.
Y'all be wrong all y'all want. It's fine.
He didn't play Torpedo Girl, but he was like, all right, Worden, number four.
Yeah, he played In My Dreams. Yeah, whatever.
Heck yeah. In My Dreams, we play.
In Your Dreams. Like, or that, what's Gary? That Bottom of Nation they did, Dream Warriors? God, that was horrible. With a horrible movie, too. Ugh.
That wasn't a great song.
No that wonder movie was,
like
no
when they get out there, like, they get out there with the things. Who is it? Who is that? Rosanna Arquette doing that?
Patricia Arquette.
That was the best part of that video, not the song and not the movie.
No wonder you like Torpedo Girl.
Yes, I do. Yeah, you're wrong. Okay.
You're wrong.
Is it my four night? My four now? Can I talk now, Stevie?
Number four.
Okay. Number four is where it all started for me with hard rock and heavy metal, at least. Before I got into this band, it was Glenn Campbell. It was Alabama was my big band. Madonna. I mean, I was in the pop. But my neighbor brought over this album, put it on. I heard the bells. I was like, what the hell is this? And then you hear the bells ring, and then you hear some guy yelling about Satan. And, of course, everything that I wasn't supposed to know. And then it got into, you know, Giving the Dog a Bone, which was like, man, they like dogs, huh? Back in Black, You Shook Me All Night Long, Rock and Roll Ain't Noise Pollution, Back in Black, Angus Young. It started for me, hard rock and heavy metal. It just, that's what got me into it. I mean, I knew who Kiss was visually, but I had no idea who they were in 1983. Right. And, you know, we talked about Mutt Lange earlier, another album he produced that just, I mean, got me. I mean, this AC/DC symbolized everything I wasn't supposed to like at that age, you know, and I remember, you know, them talking about Satan, and they just did that to, you know, piss off the preachers, which it got people like me to buy it, heathen that I am. And I still listen to AC/DC to this day. I love them. To me, and I know that people, I think they're the greatest hard rock band ever. That's my opinion. People can disagree, whatever. I think through and through, yeah, they may do the same album every year, but just in and out. I mean, a lot of people like AC/DC. They aren't necessarily hard rock fans. And to me, Angus is just, he's up there. He's my number four.
Okay. Angus Young. Okay. No problem with that pick.
And no comments? Wow. Neither one of y'all?
Hey, I mean.
Wow.
I'm not a fan.
Really?
of the band. I think he's pretty cool. His energy is undeniable. I mean, I've seen him live, and that man doesn't stop. I don't know how he does it. He's unbelievable. You know, great showman. Just not a big fan of that kind of their style.
Most of my musician fans aren't either. I mean, maybe it's more of this the simpleton like I am that's not a musician. But I have some musician friends that they feel the same way. I see your point.
Yeah, I mean he's definitely an icon, and a lot of guys are influenced by him, and he's known. I mean he's probably one of they probably rank him in the top 20 hard rock guitar players, you know, ever.
I just love AC/DC. They're like, me and Stevie did a podcast on it, and I started out being a Brian guy, but I mean my list was 5 and 5, Brian and,
yeah,
and
yeah.
I mean it's like I didn't even try it that way, but
right.
When that comes on, I mean, I listen to them all the time, but
yeah,
had to put one of my favorite bands go up there.
No, absolutely. There's certain songs like Let's Get It Up and Hell's Bells. Oh, yeah. And I love those songs. Absolutely.
Gotcha.
All right. So number 4 and I had to get this guy in because one of the most brilliant intros to a song, to an iconic song, was so simple.
Scotty Hill.
Yes, you guessed it. You sure? You just guessed it right.
Monkey Business.
Yeah, but no, just listen to this song and then hearing the story, and it never hit me till after I heard the story told about how he was just fooling around, playing a circus music, and it went from circus music to okay. Let's go with that. Let's build around that. And turns into one of the most iconic songs of the 80s and probably music. Talking about Sweet Child of Mine. I'm talking about Slash.
You got me on that one. Yeah.
Yeah. Just fooling around playing, like I said, circus music. You listen to that riff, that opening riff, that's circus music. And then they built around it, built a freaking killer song like Sweet Child of Mine around that. But yeah,
I think Appetite for Destruction is the greatest rock and roll metal debut album of all time. It's my favorite.
It's old. Yeah.
I know it's old and overplayed, but Paradise City, I still love that song. And the way he plays that solo at the end. Yes. I mean, like we were talking about how they cut off Zach on different stuff. They play that full solo on Paradise City because that's so integrated in the song. They couldn't really, you know, get it out of there, but Appetite for Destruction. I have nothing but love for Slash. I saw them with Metallica and Guns. I saw Metallica and Guns N' Roses in 93, I think, Faith No More opened at the Astrodome in Houston. And I remember I wasn't high on Guns N' Roses at the time because Axl just turned me off. I was, of course, a Metallica fan, but he came out playing the Godfather theme. How cool is that?
Yeah.
And I saw him about 4 years ago with ZZ Top. ZZ Top opened with still Dusty Hill was around, and they were great. I mean, they were, Slash is just, Duff's my favorite guy of the band, but you know, I mean, Guns N' Roses gets a lot of crap and, you know, Axl's a cause of it, but great guitar player.
And one of my favorite Guns N' Roses songs is November Rain. And you hear the guitar solo on that when he's just freaking awesome. But Slash, it just looks like, and then after you get away from that actual distraction and go to Velvet Revolver.
Oh yeah.
And what was the name of that song? Gosh, the first song they put out.
Why did you say that, Stevie? Now it's like, I forgot.
Gosh, but the solo he
Slither,
did.
Was
that,
it Slither or Slither?
Slither. 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 Yeah. Slither. The guitar solo on Slither is freaking, it sounds like, I mean, I'm like, this has just gone to another level.
What was the ballad? The second song.
I Fall to Pieces.
Yeah.
I
Fall to Pieces, Patsy Cline.
Yeah.
That guitar. See, that's the Slash. I don't like when Slash plays fast. I like when he sits back and plays melodic, like November Rain. Like yeah. The Sweet Child of Mine. Yeah. Not the Sweet Child of Mine solo, but the kind of like solos after the verses, those little like that's so it's so nice. And same thing in that Velvet Revolver song. Same thing, just a nice, really cool like riff slash lick in there. I don't like his tone. I don't know what it is about his tone I don't like.
Yeah, it's different, it's recognizable.
You could hear him anywhere.
Oh yeah, definitely.
It's just, you know, he plays the standard just Les Paul like everybody else does, but his style is very, very unique. He's a little bit sloppy, which is kind of cool. It fits the band. I mean, you can't.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. It's perfect for them.
It's perfect.
And Stevie, are you ready for that 400 song?
Yeah.
Use Your Illusions 1 and 2 coming out?
You know, I think that's a little overkill there. I mean, but, you know, people will buy it.
What's it called? I don't know what when you're talking to yourself.
It's strange.
Strange. Yeah. I mean that guitar that he does a song called. There's a song called Black Horse or Dead Horse.
Dead Horse.
That he has a great solo in too. That.
Yeah, you know, I mean
that's great.
Strange was that right there was something different, but daggum Slash. Mm. Yeah, and just like you said, Joe, he's sloppy, but it fits Guns N' Roses.
He's the perfect guitar player for that band. Perfect. Yeah. You couldn't drop somebody like a more technical player into that band. It just wouldn't work, you know.
And I think you can kind of tell the sound with somebody like him and Eddie Van Halen.
Yeah.
You know their sound. Like they fit their band. And you know that's Angus, you know that's Slash, you know.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right. Hey, that was a pretty good non-musician observation, man. Pretty good, man. Yeah,
I was impressed. That was good.
Put my little star right here, you know.
Number three, Mr. Decker.
Number three is a repeat. I think you had him. Yes, you had him.
Who's you?
I'm sorry, Stevie had him. Yeah.
One of you.
So at the time there was two guitar players who I was following greatly back in like the not the mid, like the early 80s, like 84, 85, and who were my two favorites. And I saw them both live, and I picked this one because this one was way better live than the other one. The other one was George Lynch. I was a huge, Breaking the Chains, Tooth and Nail, Under Lock and Key. Okay.
Great albums, by the way.
Great albums. But then when I saw Jakey Lee live, I said, oh no, Jake is just way, so it was kind of like Bark at the Moon, Tooth and Nail, Ultimate Sin, Under Lock and Key. And I was following both of them very, very closely. But again, the live performance is what did it for me in so many different ways. The animosity between Dokken and George on stage was undeniable. You could see it. You could feel it. You know, even as a 15-year-old kid seeing him live, you knew something wasn't quite right. The chemistry wasn't there. You know, there's that. You could tell why that band didn't go further. But then to see Jake live and him and Ozzy, the chemistry was there. The playing was there. It's a shame there was only two Ozzy albums with him, but I love the Badland stuff. I thought that was phenomenal. Yeah. And I wish he'd do something now, just do something. He's kind of off the radar. I can't find him anywhere. I can't find him on YouTube. I can't find him on Instagram. And what's funny is years ago, a girl that I knew was running his fan club. So I see a lot of stuff. Yeah. And so, he's my second favorite guitar player that Ozzy, yeah, definitely my second favorite guitar player. So, yeah, Jakey Lee, that's my number three.
So, all I'm hearing is that not only is Lynch Mob better than Dokken, so is everything Ozzy did is better than Dokken. I agree. Good point. Just kidding.
Yeah, but you talked about Dokken, and I meant to say it a while ago. You were talking about how volatile the relationship was there. You know, you remember the last single they did before they broke up the first time?
Dokken?
Yeah.
The last single?
Yeah.
It was something awful, like Too High to Fly, maybe?
No. I mean, before they broke up the first time.
They
broke up in the 80s after they did, gosh. They did the back, live album, Beast from the
Back East. From the Attack, or East from the
Back
East.
From the Attack was the last studio. Then they did the live album, but they did a studio song for that album. And I think
Walk Away?
Yes. I think
I love that fitting. Song.
I love Walk Away is one of my favorite Dawkins songs.
Yeah, me too. I love that song.
And I
yeah.
think it was so fitting that that was the last single they did before they broke up that time.
Oh, yeah.
That yeah. The song was just like, just walk away. There'll be no more tomorrow. I mean, geez. You get, and yeah. those guys, that's what kills me about it. Those guys had everything in front of them. I mean, everything in front of them. They could have went up to the next level, and they just threw it away.
They didn't have what you call a handsome singer. That's probably what killed them.
And he wasn't a great front man. I saw Dawkins a couple of times live, and he really – he. You know, certain frontmen command the crowd. You know, Vince Neil, awful singer, amazing frontman. those videos. I got to make me more of those videos. You know, I just recently listened to one of, what's that, Grown Up Rock podcast. It was a Dio Ozzy comparison. It was really, really good. But they're comparing the two, and why one was farther than the other. And I think the reason was, you know, Ozzy was a great frontman. Dio was okay, you know. Same thing I think with Dawkin. Dawkin was just he was an okay frontman, but he really did not get the crowd. You know, there was the chemistry wasn't there. I saw it.
So.
Keep making excuses for an average band. So
whatever.
They so are. They're average. They're Dawkins okay, but they're not what you call great. I mean, that's my opinion. I'm just saying, you know, that's why they never caught on, because I mean they didn't catch on. I mean, Bret Michaels can't sing, but he's a good looking dude.
Yeah.
And he's a frontman. I mean, Joe's right about that place.
He's a frontman.
I mean, I never thought Dawkins. I mean, when I was in the 80s, I looked at Dawkins. I was like, you know, what stood out to me was George Lynch. But, and, you know, like when they did, like, It's Not Love or whatever. I mean, that's a cool song because it's the wow. And the guitar, it ain't the frontman. You got to, like Joe said, you got to be able to command. You got to be a Bach. You got to be even a Vince Neil. And I think that's why they never caught. I just never thought that they were. That's why I say Lynch Mob, and there's no comparison. I mean, it's just choice, but you know, that's
you. All right. So you're number three.
My number three, I was listening to this today, and that? I remember a certain band in the, I think it was 80s and maybe 90s did this song, and it reminded me how great it was. It was Great White. They were doing Babe, I'm Gonna Leave You. And this song came on, the original came on. I don't know if it's the original, if it's a cover, but the Zeppelin came on, and I'm thinking, God, this song is older than me, and it just still, Babe, I'm Gonna Leave, just kicks so much ass. And just Jimmy Page, I mean, I love this. I don't know, it's hard to say. I mean, it's Led Zeppelin. I'm a huge Zeppelin fan. Mm-hmm. And you think about all the stuff he influenced. I mean, he had the White Snakes, the Kingdom Comes. I mean, there's still people ripping him off today. I mean, playing the guitar with the fiddle thing or whatever.
With the bow.
I mean, yeah, the bow. I mean, yeah. You know, granted, he was, lived in Aleister Crowley's house. That was a little weird. But Jimmy Page, man, I mean, Zeppelin's up there with one of my favorite bands. And Eddie Van Halen spoke highly of him. I think he was more enamored with like him and Clapton. So,
yeah.
And Clapton's great, but Jimmy Page, and he seems like a good guy. He's out there and he's, you know, he worked with Robert Plant. I kind of wish they'd release more Coverdale Page stuff. I was really disappointed that didn't do better, but like timing, 94.
Yep.
Yeah.
But Jimmy Page.
Okay.
All right. Nothing wrong with that.
Nope.
I have to say, I've been getting messages back and forth. I mean, we're not live or anything like that, but I've been getting messages back and forth. One of the guys that back in high school that really influenced what I listened to a lot, he was an older guy, and when we go on bus rides for ball games, he would play the coolest stuff, and he introduced me to a lot of stuff. So I asked him right then, who was your favorite guitarist of all time? And, just like you said, Jimmy Page was his favorite. So,
yeah, I mean, I think with Zeppelin, it's either you like them or you don't.
I mean,
you had a lot of
taste.
Yeah.
I don't get that. I mean, I don't understand. I mean, that's just me though. I think they're great. I'm not saying
they're not great, but I'm just saying it's.
But I don't think they're an acquired taste. I think that's. I don't.
Well, for a lot of people, they are.
Well, I think Pink Floyd's an acquired taste. I think Led Zeppelin's more broadband.
Let me tell you this: compared to Led Zeppelin, Pink Floyd is not even a taste for me.
Yeah, that's true. But I'm just saying, I think Pink Floyd. I mean, I think Zeppelin's higher than that.
Oh yeah, definitely.
But there's no comparison for me
with Led Zeppelin.
But you know what I'm saying? I don't think they're. I mean. Yeah,
but some people just feel that way. You know, it's not me. I love that Led Zeppelin, but you know, it's an acquired taste.
But
for
it's
some people.
I those people are wrong. I'm sorry. I think Zeppelin's one of the greatest rock. I mean, when you sell your soul to the devil, man, come on, you got to be great. Robert Johnson Part Two. Come on, dude.
Okay. All right, Jimmy Page is number three.
I guess Joe's one of those people that's acquired taste for. He's not as
well. I'm just thinking, like, you know, Jimmy Page, you know, probably the most identifiable guitar solo ever, "Stairway to Heaven." Everyone knows that, you know. And I'm not a huge Zeppelin fan. There's songs I love by them. But this is not going to be the popular opinion. If I was going to sit down and listen to two guitar players, I'd rather listen to David Gilmour than Jimmy Page. That's just my personal, you know, taste. I like Floyd better. I think he's just a different kind of guitar player. But Page is like most of the guys that are around today, or you know, in the '80s, they wouldn't have been around if it wasn't Jimmy Page. You know, the Zeppelin started all that.
Ace Frehley is one of them. I think that was the big influence on what Ace was, Jimmy Page.
Yeah.
I also like the Adrian Vandenbergs and who's the guy that was in the band before they kicked him out? John Sykes.
Yeah.
Let me tell you this, dude. John Sykes, I don't know what the problem was with him, if it was attitude or what, but that guy could flat out play some guitar. I mean,
Carbondale, there weren't room for two stars in that band. It was just Carbondale's.
Yeah, his ego must have been really bad because he was not. There was no way Carbondale was going to let him tell him what to do.
I disagree because he fired the whole band, not just Sykes. So
well, yeah, but that's
and that band wasn't exactly what you call a handsome band. Besides Carbondale and Sykes, you know,
and
they
were. What he did. Then he gets Vivian and Adrian Vandenberg and Rudy Sarzay.
Steve Aldridge there one time. They had the freaking what you call a super group back.
It was an all-star band. You know? Yeah.
So it was a lot better than that band Shadow King that Adrian did too. That was horrible.
You just listen to Vandenberg.
What was that song All the Way to Memphis that had the
that was Contraband.
Yeah, Contraband.
It had
a great single, but the rest of the album
was great. Now that was Bobby Blotzer from Rat played the drums.
But the rest of the album stunk. That single was great.
Yeah. But that single like you said, was great. Who was the singer in that? Was it the guy from LA Guns?
I think so. Phil Lewis?
Yeah, I think it was Phil Lewis. But yeah, the great, great song. But yeah, like you said, Warren, I'll agree with that. The rest of the album was not great.
That happened a lot. You buy like, one album, you're like, oh man, the rest of it
sucked. My brother actually bought a cassette single with that. That's how I knew about that song. And then later on, like with the album challenge thing, that was one of them. I went and listened to the whole album and I was like, oh yeah, there was a reason why they didn't take off.
And I think Shadow King was with Lou Gramm, and Lou Gramm's one of my favorite singers, of course, from Foreigner. It was just horrible.
Yeah. So number three for me, and this is going to be the last of the Aussie guitar players. No surprise who this is. The late, great Randy Rhoads. Remember when I started getting into, you know, like Ultimate Sin, listening to Aussie stuff, and then going back to Bark at the Moon, and then reading up, you know, Hit Parader or Circus would have stuff about Randy Rhoads, how great Randy Rhoads was. And then I don't think I bought Blizzard until after I heard, I don't know if you remember, 87, Ozzy did the tribute album.
Yep.
The live recording of a concert with Randy Rhoads. And I'm sitting there listening to that. I was like, holy crap, I've got to go out and get Blizzard now. And went out, got Blizzard after that. And I mean, just like we talked about Vito Bratta, it wasn't around a long time, but think about what Randy Rhoads would have done. I mean, I know there was a lot of talk about he was going to quit rock music and just go do like classic. He was going to change. I mean, he could have changed the face of music with what he was talking about doing classical stuff. And you hear it a little bit in what Diary of a Madman. You hear a little bit of that classical stuff in that. And I love Diary of a Madman when he does the intro to that and the guitar solo. That was just great. But yeah, what could we have seen from Randy Rhoads, if his life hadn't been cut short by that plane crash? But then again, we would not get to see Jake Lee. And probably, well, you know, you may have been, because Sharon probably would have just aggravated Randy Rhoads till he quit.
There
was already talk about that. Rumors about that anyway.
Yep.
But, Randy Rhoads, my number three.
Randy Rhoads, I remember growing up. I mean, I was a Sabbath fan before I was an Aussie fan, really, because the Road Warriors came out to Iron Man, and I remember how heavy it was. And I remember finally getting Blizzard of Oz, and I remember hearing Crazy Train. I'm thinking, God, this is nothing heavy compared to Sabbath. But I mean, it was different because, you know, Iommi with the heavy chords and Randy with. But I just remember that Ozzy seemed a little bit less until he got Zach in the band. He was a little bit more. It wasn't as heavy. It wasn't as fat sounding as it was with Zach Wilde. It was more, like you said, that classical.
Yeah.
The Blizzard of Oz, that was classic rock. That was stuff that's why Crazy Train's probably played, because it's not the heavy stuff that, you know, the later stuff was. But I see your point, Stevie, on that.
Yeah. All right.
Well, since we're on the topic, it's my number two. Randy's my number two.
Okay.
I haven't had this thing sitting right here. I remember I bought this years ago when I first started playing guitar.
Wow.
Yeah, and I've had this thing sitting, you know, forever. He's the reason I picked up a guitar, hands down, Randy Rhoads, you know.
And he's not your number one. Wow.
He's not my number one. Wow. And I'll tell you why when we get there. But I wanted to play like him. You know, at the time when he came around, it was him and Eddie Van Halen were kind of like the two new hotshots. You know, Van Halen's style was so unique and odd and almost impossible to learn. I mean, you know, whammy bars, tapping techniques. It was insane. Well, Randy is a true, he's technical. Like, all his scales are, that you can, it's easier to play like him than it is to play like Eddie Van Halen. You know, so I gravitated more towards Randy than towards Eddie Van Halen. You know, I wasn't a huge fan of Ozzy. It was him, you know. And I was only about 11 or 12 when I think Blizzard came out, and I loved that. Mr. Crowley was like I played that song thousands of times. And then when Diary came out, kind of like you said, Stevie, the title track was so haunting, and there was so much. It was actually scared me a little bit. I mean, I was probably
It's eerie.
Yeah,
it's eerie. It's really, really. And the cover of that album was really eerie. And Ozzy looked like a monster, and the upside down cross in the background, and the little kid sitting back there was Ozzy's kid. You know,
good stuff. Good stuff. Great stuff.
You know, and then, you know, Over the Mountain, Flying High Again, Can't Kill Rock and Roll, you know, Sado, Believer. I love that. I prefer Diary over Blizzard, you know, and it's funny because I've heard Randy wasn't happy with the Diary album at all. He felt like he was rushed through it. He never could. I would have never known that his playing on there is phenomenal. What's interesting on the Blizzard album, you guys probably heard this before, is from what I read about when that was being made and being produced, the guitars were all triple tracked, you know, and so he was playing those solos note for note three times. You know, one pan to the left, one pan to the right, one pan dead center. And that's why when you hear the solos on there, they sound very full, but they sound kind of weird. And when you watch it live, you hear his live stuff, you can pick the notes out better because it's not quite perfect on the Blizzard. Like to play, you know, a solo perfectly the same way three times, that's nearly impossible to do, you know. And it's sad to hear that he wasn't happy towards the end. Like, I hate to think of him, you know, in his last days, not being happy with what he was doing. But from what you read, he wasn't happy with it. He wanted to leave the band. Yeah, he wanted to leave. And it is, you wonder what he'd been doing. You know, the guy left, he was 24 years old, you know, with, other than the Quiet albums, which I did not, was not a fan of. If you've heard those, they're really hard to get through. They're not fun to listen to at all.
Like anything that band does.
Just not good, you know, just not.
Yeah, exactly. Anything that band does. That's why their two biggest hits are covers.
I'm not a big fan either, but you know, Randy Rhoads has been my favorite guitar player since I was 12, you know, and so he's definitely the guy for me, and I, there's so much I could say, but you know, other than he was the guy. He was the guy.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Number two, Worden.
Okay, now I know for a fact that my two and one aren't on y'all's list.
All right.
Okay.
Oh,
my number two.
Ugh.
But it's not just one guitar player, it's that tandem. It's Perry and Whitford. Because I think these two with Aerosmith's sound, I think they go together, that you don't know who's playing what. And Brett and Joe Perry gets all the credit because he used to be pretty. But Whitford does a lot of the heavy lifting as well. So it's that, you know, that, like you're talking about Judas Priest and stuff like that. I think Perry Whitford do it. And I mean, Aerosmith's in my top five, one of my favorite bands. And Joe Perry and Brad Whitford, I think they're like, when they don't play together, they're like, when he's in Hollywood Vampires, it's not the same as when he's with Aerosmith with Whitford.
Right.
And when they left the band, you saw how the band kind of deteriorated. Perry Whitford, they're, I mean, you guys aren't going to agree. They're not on the Oz list probably, but I mean, I love Aerosmith and I don't think it would be the same without Whitford. That's why I got to put him up there with Joe Perry.
Wasn't there an album where Perry and Whitford didn't play on?
Yeah. I think it was, Rockin' a Hard Place.
Rockin' a Hard Place. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's good, but it's not Aerosmith.
Yeah.
You know.
I've never listened to it. So I don't, I mean,
I saw, there's a band that Whitford was in called Whitford St. Holmes. Guy that was, they opened up for Whitesnake. I saw Whitesnake about 4 years ago. And that dude, St. Holmes can still sing. They were great. And I went back and listened to their stuff. But Brad Whitford's another Bruce Kulick, another Mick Mars that doesn't get,
doesn't get a lot of it. You're right. You're exactly right.
But he's probably one of the only few people that, I mean, and Steven said this, that stands up to Steven Tyler besides Joe Perry. But I love Aerosmith. I love the 70s. I love the 80s stuff. 90s, meh. But those two together, I just can't imagine them without Whitford.
No, I agree with you. I think he is one of the unsung guys. It's so often the rhythm guitar players don't get enough credit, you know, and you're right. They do a lot of the work. Like, you know, one of the bands that we didn't talk about, though, but the guys in my honorable mention later on is Y&T. You know, their rhythm guitar player is phenomenal, and no one ever talks about him. No one even knows his name, you know. And there's a lot of guys like that do a lot of the. They make the guitar player shine. It's kind of like being a lineman in football. You're doing a lot of the heavy work. You're not getting a lot of the credit. You're making someone else look good. It's a humbling thing. So no, I'm with you. I think those two together. I'm not a big Aerosmith fan, but the combination of those two, they definitely create a very unique sound. And I think that one would not be the same without the other.
Whitford plays a lot more lead than a lot of fans know. You know, being a Aerosmith fan.
Yeah.
And he writes too, and that's a lot of rhythm guitarists don't do.
Nope. Very true.
All right.
There's a part on I was listening to it today. It's Dream On. Mm-hmm. And it's the live version, and I don't know where it's from, but it's I think it's called South. It's like one of their live albums, and you hear Steven Tyler coming up to Brad Whitford, and his wife probably had to be in the crowd, like, "Hey, Whitford, what are you doing? Checking out the babes?" I was like, "Oh man, your wife's there, great."
Jeez.
All right, number two for me. Both of you guys have already had him.
Oh well.
Yeah. And
I wonder who this is. Could be. Do I know who this is, Stevie?
Well, you've already had him on your list, so I mean, but there's a couple of them that you've already had on your list.
Look at the cross. I got it.
I think I know who your top two are.
Yeah, number two for me is Eddie Van Halen.
Mm-hmm.
From hearing Diver Down. And, you know, everybody talks about Eruption and all this stuff, but my introduction to Eddie Van Halen was I don't know if you remember the instrumental before Pretty Woman Intruder.
Yeah.
Yes, and it sounds, you know what it sounds like.
That's a badass intro.
Yeah, it's, I mean, I was like, this is freaking awesome here. This guy is making things. And then, you know, Jump, just like Joe was talking about, there was so much controversy about, well, he's not playing guitar, he's playing keyboards. But it worked out. I mean, and then look at how many songs he played keyboards on down the line. He was multi-talented, but I mean, I remember, and I may be wrong if anybody had ever done this before, Pound Cake.
Yeah.
Just started Pound Cake when he takes the drill across.
That was interesting. Yeah.
Yes, that was something different, but so many great songs that he did. And like you said,
didn't they rip off Mr. Big for doing that? Mr. Big did that first.
I don't know.
With the drill. Because I remember my buddy said, hey, they ripped off Mr. Big. I'm like, who's Mr. Big?
Yeah, exactly. That's the right answer. Who's Mr. Big? You know,
They didn't want to be with you at the times, Joe, but
deep inside, you feel it too, Warden. But anyway, Eddie Van Halen, I mean,
that song. Okay.
Just take my heart, Stevie. Come on. What? Paul Gilbert's on your list, Joe?
No. Oh, Paul Gilbert, Billy Sheehan. I remember that band. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yep. Billy Sheehan, I mean, because he ends up in the David Lee Roth band for Eat 'Em and Smile.
Yeah, no, Paul Gilbert did something with a drill, and nobody had heard of Mr. Big until that song, and this was years before. So
he had that distinct sound, no doubt about it. The tapping was great, but I just remember he was probably the first, other than Ace Frehley, he was probably the first big time guitar player that I really like. This guy could freaking play, and it was just a sign of things to come later on. But he goes through Sammy, David Lee, and he's still doing the same old thing. He did such a great job. But Eddie Van Halen, rest in peace. He's my number two on my list.
I remember you talking about Pound Cake. I remember that part where after he goes that dunna dunna. That's when he like that part with the, it's almost acoustic like. But it's the keyboards are so heavy in that song, and then you hear that dunna. He hits that guitar part. I don't know what.
And I've said this many a time, but one of my favorite Van Halen songs, because it's heavier than most Van Halen song, was Off Balance.
Thanks for ignoring just what I said about the dunna dunna. I mean, that's my musician. You just totally go to another song. See,
listen,
whatever.
Listen.
Man, I was trying to impress Joe with my dunna dunna, but I guess it didn't work either. Whatever.
You really impressed me. Next thing you're going to be doing.
Well, I gotta get a lot to get your attention, Stevie. All that about it. Okay, never mind. Well, this song here, whatever.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, Don't Tell Me What Love Can Do.
Yeah, great song.
That was
that's a good one. Yeah.
Eddie, it just sounded different than anything Eddie had done before to me. But man, oh gosh, I remember hearing that the first time. I was like, yeah, this is freaking awesome here. But yeah, Eddie Van Halen, number two for me.
Talk about a departure for Van Halen. What was that song? I posted on one of my pages the other day. I think it was that the All Things Rock. What's the name of the song? It's off. I think it's Off Balance.
Is it the ballad?
It's that ballad that has that weird, like on the intro, has that real thing where he's playing with the.
What's the name of that freaking thing? I remember it.
Hurts you sometimes. That one. That was I mean, Sammy sings his heart out, but that's a great solo.
And it is a great song. Another thing we talk about here, the timing.
Yep.
If that had been 3 years before, that probably would have been a big hit. And I'm looking right now to see what the name of the
song. That one song, that other ballad they did was
Not Enough.
Yeah. They had another song that was, that one that was on that same album was a big hit.
Can't Stop
Loving. That was a big hit.
Yeah, that's a good great song. Yeah.
See, they were one of the bands that could get away with that happy stuff in the 90s. You know what I mean?
But you know, that video, Eddie doesn't look really happy the whole time in that video.
He's smiling.
No, he doesn't.
He doesn't look, because he had cut his hair, he had a goatee. And he just doesn't look like he's happy in that video.
Well, he's not going to be as happy as he was in Jump because he wasn't drinking anymore, probably.
Probably so. All right. Mr. Decker, number one.
Number one, you guys probably figured it out by now, but from my favorite band, it's got to be Ace Frehley. And for a lot of different reasons. All right. Well, he was probably my, you know, I found Kiss in like third grade and just thought like, you know, Ace Frehley was like the coolest thing ever. You know, I think the first album I heard by them was Alive One. And to me, the first Alive album, that is a guitar clinic. He's putting on you know, his playing on that is phenomenal. You know, the makeup, the exploding guitars, everything Ace Frehley is, the sloppiness of who he is, just his whole persona and image is just, you know, as a young kid, so impressionable. Loved him over the years. He's another guy, kind of like Felder. Someone told him how to craft a guitar solo. He does the same thing. He plays very similar lines with like one note difference, call and response. I love everything about him. Now here's what I'll say though, as far as my top two go, and here's the difference. I wanted to play like Randy Rhoads, but I wanted to be Ace Frehley. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So that's the difference. That's why those two are my two top, you know. I don't want to be Ace now. I definitely want to be Randy now. Don't want to be Randy now, but that's the difference, you know. But how can you go wrong with him? I don't think of the Ace now. I think of the Ace back in the mid-70s wheelhouse, maybe even in the early 80s, you know, maybe in the Dynasty, maybe. But that's my favorite.
Okay. Yeah, I'll talk a little bit about that in a minute.
Gee, I wonder why. I told y'all my number one wasn't going to be on y'all's list. Number one, or can I go, Stevie, or do you have something?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off like you do me.
You go ahead.
Shush. Oh, you heard that. Oh, you're paying attention. Yeah, good job.
I'm paying attention.
Okay, my number one is not so much a lead guitar player. He's more he is the sound of this band, and this band's sound is probably my favorite in all of rock music. They're not technically my favorite band, but they're number two after, you know, Kiss. I think he's heart and soul of the band. And I can't understand half the shit he's saying in interviews, but Keith Richards, I just love the Stones, and I love the sound. I mean, it's funny. I hear like when I can hear the Stones and other bands like that, Tumbling Down by John Cougar Mellencamp. That's a Stones lick at the beginning. I hear Keith in so much stuff that, I mean, like I said, you know, Can You Hear Me Knocking? I mean, you think about the song Bitch. I mean, Gene ripped that off to get Deuce. I mean, I think the Stones are the greatest rock band of all time. And I think I just put them above the Beatles. This is my list because longevity. Yeah. I think it's longevity. And I think they did it. I think there's been better guitar players in the band, like Ron Wood and maybe Mick Taylor and Brian Johnson. But Keith is, to me, the Stones. I mean, well, of course, him and Mick. But, I mean, that sound, that rhythm sound, that's all Keith, and that's what I like about it.
Okay.
Agreed. I'm not a huge Stones fan, but there's a number of songs I do like by them. But you're absolutely right. He is the sound of that band. No doubt.
Yeah, no doubt about it.
And then, like I said, they're right below Kiss for me. I mean, and I think because the Stones have been in my wheelhouse longer. I mean, I like Kiss overall more, but Stones are pretty close.
And they're so much fun. They're even live. I mean, I saw them before COVID it was, but and I went there as not a huge fan of theirs, but I know all their songs. You know all the songs, you know. And I had so much fun at that concert because they put a hell of a show on, and they sounded great. I mean, this is kind of blasphemy, but I actually enjoyed their show better than the Kiss show, you know, because I thought there was a lot more energy there. There's a lot more energy, you know, not only on the stage, but from the crowd. The crowd is a lot more, you know, into it.
Yeah, know? Mick's not a great singer, but he fits the Stones. Totally. But he's not like what Paul's doing. He didn't blow his voice out like Paul or Vince.
Right.
I mean, he fits. I mean, he's got a good 10 years on him probably.
They had a big band up there too. I mean, the sound coming out of off that stage was just like a wall hitting you.
I've seen them twice. I saw them in 94. Brian Adams actually opened. It was a Voodoo Lounge, and they had all the blow up. And that was the greatest. That's the best show I've seen in my life. That's been some of my favorite show.
Yeah.
And I saw them in 2002, and they played. I worked for Clear Channel at the time. They were giving tickets away, and me and my buddy went, and we got it was a stripped down more show. I think it was around the time they did Stripped or whatever, when they did, hey, like a Rolling Stone or whatever. Mm-hmm. But it was more without the pirate. It was them playing. And it's like they can prove without the rest of the stuff.
Yeah.
I had tickets to see them before COVID. COVID came along and got canceled and Charlie died. So it's like,
right.
That's one band I'll probably go see if they do it again, because you keep saying, you talk about Kiss and Aerosmith and them being, oh God, the Stones are really.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and the fact that they're still doing it at that age, and they're putting on great shows. From what
it's not a joke.
I'm not a big Stones fan, but you still got to give credit where credit's due. They're putting on shows that people want to go see, and then it's not just the diehard fans. People want to go see it because it's the Rolling Stones.
And you have a lot of stuff that aren't necessarily hits that are songs, like Dancing with Dr. or is it Mr. D? I think it's about. I mean, that stuff, you can tell it's influenced other bands, and they're not even hits. That's how deep their stuff is.
Yeah.
Sorry, John. I mean to cut you off.
No, and they put a respectable show on. It's not like a joke. I mean, some bands just pack it in. You know, they're done. I'm starting to feel that way about Kiss a little bit, kind of, you know. Man. But their show was very, very good. And I recognized almost all the songs, and other than the deep tracks. But I thought they were great. I'd go see them again. I would definitely go see them again.
I remember when Steel Wheels was real out and they were talking about their age. They were in their 40s at the time.
Yeah.
They've still been doing that 30 years later. It's amazing.
That is amazing.
And death doesn't stop it. They're like ZZ Top. You know, you're gone. Hey, we're going back on tour.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Gee, Stevie. Who the fuck could your number one be? Vinnie Vincent.
Yeah. My favorite Kiss guitarist, Vinnie Vincent. Now, you know who it is. No surprise. It is Ace Frehley. You know, as a kid, that was the one I always like, was like, oh, the guy from space, the spaceman. And wanted to, you know, I always played air guitar, playing Alive or Alive 2 on my record player. And then, you know, you've all heard the story about how I tried to do the smoke bomb thing in the plastic guitar and ended up melting the guitar.
Hey, at first you don't succeed. Try again, Stevie.
Yep. But you know, I mean, we talked earlier about, you were talking about how Ace was and how if he hadn't, he got lazy, and he did get lazy. And I mean, I think that a lot of it had to do with addiction, a lot. And he was complacent, just like you said too, Joe. Can you imagine? And I remember listening, and we keep bringing Tom and Zeus into the conversation when they were talking about the Winterland show. Mm. Can you, it's just like they made a great point. Can you imagine if Ace had that same drive that he did in that Winterland show and kept that all through his time with Kiss, what we would have seen as far as Kiss goes? Because I mean, I'm like them, that Winterland show, they were hungry. They wanted it. You know, I think once they got that success, it was kind of like, oh, we're, you know, him and Peter were like, we can rest on our laurels. Now we're Kiss. We don't have to do anything. But can you imagine if he still had that drive? Cause I think after that, he never got it back, but man, he was so great while he was in Kiss, especially the first time in Kiss.
I think the solo album, like I said before.
Well, yeah, he kind of,
because he mentions that all the time. Oh, I had the best solo album, you know.
Yeah.
Well, but that's arguable too. You know, I'm probably leaning more towards Paul's, but Ace's was great. But what's that latest off the soundboard?
The 77 from Hour.
That's a great one.
He's on fire.
He is. I mean, it's great.
Fire on there. I mean, I'm listening to him thinking, holy shit, this guy can't play a guitar. You know, like he hadn't forgotten how. And that's raw. That's not mixed. That's just like, that's him playing.
It's off the soundboard.
so good. So good.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That one, from listening to the first three songs, I was like, this is supposed to be off the soundboard, not mixed, and this sounds better than the live two.
I know. It's...
Well, the live two, the audience is so upped up, it kind of ruins it for me.
I wasn't a big fan of the set list either. Yeah. I mean, I thought the set list was, you know, phenomenal
live.
You know, yeah. It's interesting to think about. Like, you know, it's a shame he lost that fire. It's a shame he got complacent, you know, money, you know, you start making money and you just get lazy and that's what happens to you, you know, but, for a while there, you know, and I wonder if he'll ever, if he even was like, you know, being that we were so young back when they were on top of the world, I mean, I wasn't reading a lot of articles in magazines back then. I don't even know if he was recognized as being as good as he was back then, or if he was like, cause Kiss was kind of like the joke, you know,
they
weren't the Eagles. They weren't the Outlaws. They weren't the Doobie Brothers. They weren't Foreigner. They weren't Queen, you know, the guys that were getting all the accolades, but,
Was it 77 or 78? They won the Gallup poll as best
two
band
or three in years in a row. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah. So they won the Gallup poll. And I think, you know, of course, when you get in these polls with music bands, whoever's the most popular, they're going to start, you know, you're going to vote for the guitar player, you're going to vote for the singer.
Yeah.
Unless somebody else out there is really, really exceptional. But I think he was getting the notoriety then.
Good.
But like you said, before that, before they really hit big with like Love Gun, I think before that there was, and even, well, yeah, love before Love Gun, I think even after Destroyer, I think they were still kind of a joke.
Yeah.
But when they hit it with Love Gun and then Alive 2, it just took off, and they were huge.
Yeah.
Honestly, speaking from a kid from back then that wasn't really necessarily a Kiss fan, I think a lot of this Ace may have not gotten recognized, A, out of the makeup, but Gene was such a towering figure back then. When I remember Kiss from the 70s, that's what I remember. I remember Gene. I don't remember Paul too much or the rest of them. It was Gene.
The thing is, too, you know, after his great acting performance in Kiss Meets the Phantom, that just elevated him even more.
Are you talking about Gene or Ace?
Ace.
Oh, gotcha.
He changed colors, man. I mean, people can do that.
Stevie, I was going to ask you, what was that picture you posted on Shout Out Loudcast with him with the puppet? Stevie, do you have a private collection we don't know about or something?
He had some more talent we didn't know about, didn't he?
Yeah, I guess. He wasn't late for no card game, man. He was the card game.
Yeah, evidently.
It's funny with me getting into Kiss later. I always thought Ace was badass because I remember, I was a Kiss fan before. Gene and Paul will, you know, I say I'm a Paul guy, but I'm probably a Gene and Paul guy because that was the band I got into. But I remember that, like, just the stuff on Expose is when they show him doing that guitar.
Oh, yeah.
But I never understood, were they ragging on him when they, I'm alive and well, where am I?
Where am I?
Mean, that had to be a cutout,
yes.
Right?
I mean,
okay. Oh, yeah.
I'm H3, I'm alive and well, where am I?
But that's the one thing, like I said, I'm a Gene and Paul guy, but they still talk about their addictions.
And that's
wrong.
Yeah.
But
just beating a dead horse.
But like I said earlier about Ace, that my opinion is he could have done more. Like when I saw him in that club with LA Guns and Dawkins and Graham Bonnet, I was like, man, you're Ace Frehley. You're bigger than all these guys.
Yeah.
Maybe not, well, Graham Bonnet, but well, yeah, I guess so. Mm-hmm. But I was like, and you're playing clubs, man. I mean, you just pissed it all away. And it seems like lately he's been trying to get back in the band, but that still shipped. I really think Gene and Paul's credit, they wanted him to stay after the farewell tour.
I did.
But he didn't want to. But you listen to that soundboard and you realize he had to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was not good. But they just wanted him. You got to think with that, after hearing that soundboard, they just wanted him to stay because
they wanted
the three of the four original members. If they couldn't get, they didn't want to go back to
Peter.
Just, yeah. Yeah. And they
had to do
back.
It.
They did go back to Peter after that.
Well, they had to do it on the Aerosmith tour because Aerosmith said that you got to have three members, the original members.
Well, they also did it for the symphony.
Yeah.
In Australia, yeah. He came back for that too,
and that's when Paul told Peter that oh, we'll just put Eric in the makeup. And Peter was like, they'll never buy it. Guess they did.
Yeah.
That's when they discovered it. I think when they put, it was Peter's drum tech in the makeup on the, it's like, oh,
that was on the reunion tour.
Yeah. I bet you that's where Doc or somebody got the idea.
But let me tell you this. I don't know if you guys were on America Online back in the day.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
But they had a Kiss chat room and,
WWE one.
Yeah. I'd go into Kiss chat room just about, but mostly every night. Cause that was when the reunion tour was going on. And
are you serious? I don't remember that at all.
Oh, yeah. You'd come in there and, people would talk. And I remember,
God, America Online.
The night after that happened,
was on there. Yeah.
People were talking about that. We're talking about Peter. They were, you know how rumors get, Peter's quit. They had his drum tech on because he walked out.
Yeah, I heard that too.
Yeah. But I mean, Kiss had their own official America Online. And you know how you could put people in there and you that show when they were online?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden I look up there one night and I said, oh, it was called Alive WW. And that was the official Kiss when I was like, oh, they're online. I clicked over there and said, hey, what's up? Yeah. Didn't get a response. So I was like, one of them's looking, and it probably won't even them.
Right.
And to defend Peter, I read somewhere where I think Paul and Gene were ragging on Peter when he was back when they were on the Aerosmith tour. I saw the Aerosmith tour and it was with Peter and Thayer, and that was great. I thought they were awesome.
I heard a lot of people say he was really good.
You know what? Honestly, after Kiss, a lot of people left. I was one of them because I like Aerosmith, but watching them live is like watching paint dry. I mean, it's just, they're just not a good live band.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't mind going to see them in Vegas. I'm trying to get Stevie to go join me in Vegas for it, but we can be drunk, watch Aerosmith. We might enjoy it, It's Tyler, 77. I mean, you think about our heroes. I mean, it's crazy how old
we're going to wake up one of these days and it's going to be like, oh, this one's gone. Oh, this one's gone.
Well, we do that all the time.
It's going to happen fast.
It happens daily, man.
Yeah.
Yep. All right. I'm looking at how many we got duplicates of.
I think we all had Ace, and we all had Eddie Van Halen. Other than that,
everybody had an Ace, and then me and you had Jakey Lee, Neil Sean, and then me and
you guys
and Worden. You had Bruce Kulick.
You guys had Bruce,
and Ace. I had Ace too.
Yeah,
but yeah, we all had Ace.
We all had Ace, and we all had Eddie Van Halen.
So I knew our lists were going to be different. They were pretty much different.
Okay, honorable mentions.
Joe, you going to do your honorable mentions?
Sure. So mine, okay. How many we usually do? One. How many of these you guys? Yeah,
whatever you got, man.
Whatever you got.
He's paying the bill. He don't care.
Well, I mentioned Warren Demartini earlier. I think he's phenomenal. I love that guy. He's amazing. Bruce Kulick, he almost made my list. I was so torn. I do love Bruce. I think he's phenomenal. I had Dave Menichetti from Y&T, great blues guitar player. And last guy I had was John Petrucci, band called Dream Theater. I don't love the band, but I love him, his playing. So, and I could
what's probably his, make a, what's his last name? But
Petrucci?
Petrucci.
Petrucci, yeah. Great guitar player. Real nice. I met him a few times. Real nice guy. It's so hard to narrow this thing down. So there's some other guys I like, but that's just a couple. That's what, 15 or so right there in a nutshell. So, I really like our list. It's a pretty diverse list, you know?
Okay. Yeah. I'll go through mine because I have a longer list.
Go ahead.
The Reverend Billy Gibbons.
Yeah.
Don Felder. Adrian Smith from Iron Maiden, one of my course bands. Of course, I have written down CC Devil, but I meant CC DeVille. Another, I think, underrated guitar player. He fits the band. I mean, he's not a bad guitar player at all. He's got weird hair. He gets a lot
of crap. I mean, and me and you talked about it too. We didn't understand the hate for Poison. I don't. I enjoyed it.
I don't either. This one's going to surprise y'all. I'm not a big fan of the music. I'm not a big fan of this band, but I'm a big fan of the music. I just don't like the vocals, and that's Alex Lifeson from Rush. I like Rush's music. Geddy Lee just killed it for me. It's just unlistenable for me. Tony Iommi, Black Sabbath fan. Hendrix, how could you not have Hendrix? Brian May, I'm kind of surprised that didn't make your list, Joe. I'm a little bit surprised about that.
He was right there. Yeah.
And Stevie Ray Vaughan. Stevie Ray Vaughan almost made it. That was the one I might have chased Ace out with it, but then I remembered, hey, Ace was in your favorite band.
Right.
All right.
Here we go. 102, Steve. Joe, get your coffee ready.
All right.
Okay. First, there was that tandem of Joe Walsh and Don Felder. Mm. Mick Mars. One that we didn't really think of. I thought of, but he came close. But Prince.
Oh, yeah. I thought about that. Yeah.
Another one that was one of my first ones that I listened to, Peter Frampton.
Yeah.
You know, Tony Iommi, Stevie Ray Vaughan. Who else have I got up here? Brian May was on my the ones I had to narrow down. Jimmy Page, Eric Clapton, and George Lynch. They were the ones that I left out. But
it's funny when we're doing our lists and stuff like that. And I hate myself for this. Y'all mentioned Zakk Wylde. I didn't even consider him. There's so many out there. I forgot completely about Zakk Wylde. He would have been a honorable mentions, but I don't have him on here. That's crazy. There's so many.
I'm so glad none of us picked Joe Satriani, Steve Vai. I'm happy about that, because not that I don't like those guys, but because I do. But I don't know.
What is it? Austin Powers says it's not my kind of bag, baby.
There you go.
I remember my musician friends tell me how great and masterful Yngwie was. I'm like,
whatever. I could care less.
That's horrible.
I could care.
He's not horrible. It's not my thing.
I mean, I'm looking at our lists here, and I wouldn't call anyone across any of our lists a shredder guitar player. You know, yeah. I think we all picked guitar players who play with a lot of melody. You know, probably the only shredder, maybe Nuno.
Or George Harrison.
George Harrison. He's quite the shredder.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, bud.
He's quite the shredder.
He is.
You know, I think we all picked guitar players that play to the song. They don't overplay. They play to the music, you know, which is cool.
Yeah. So that's our top 10 guitars. Before we go, I'm going to bring this up. I got this in the mail this week. I don't know if you guys can see it. Restrained. Tony Masalam from our buddy in the Loudcaster room got the autographed new CD too. Came with a nice little guitar pick and
awesome.
And some stickers. Yeah, some stickers. So if you haven't had a chance to, if you're into that kind of thing, check out Restrained. You will not be disappointed. They are freaking awesome.
Damn, Stevie, we're going on 3 hours. Has we ever done one this long before?
Yeah, we did do one.
Did we? I don't know. The time with you, just time just stands still when I'm with you, so I don't know.
Jeez. Let's cut it off now.
I mean, anyway. It's a whole week between weeks I see you, Stevie. It's like sometimes it's two. My heart can't go on, man. Come on, Joe,
about to go into another day. You still got like an hour and a half before you're another day.
Yeah, I was still waiting for Joe to give me my answer, but you know.
What answer?
On our paranormal thing.
We're doing that. That's gonna be exciting. I'm looking forward to that.
It's not Stevie's bag, so me and Joe might.
Not my kind of bag, but Stevie's
afraid of the dark, so it's like, you know. Like, yeah, I know you're a busy guy, so I was like, I haven't heard back from him. Let me just make sure we do it. So.
I was telling somebody, I got a phone call right before we were going on from somebody that, and it was older, one of the football players I had interviewed in the past from East Carolina from my team. Mm-hmm. And every once in a while, he'll call me just to check up. And I was telling him,
Frank Gifford.
And I was like, my Friday nights are free. And I was telling him about that whole situation. He was like, man, that's crazy. What kind of crap is that?
He said, well, back Stevie, in the day, if you weren't such an outlaw, man, I mean, just, you know, exactly, making those kids do those evil things, dude.
I was the one that did it. I set up the whole thing.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, we're going on 3 hours, so we're going to just go ahead and Joe, like I said, third member.
This was fun, guys.
You like the Hulk Hogan of the NWO? You like the third member? Who's the third?
Hey, who's Hall and who's Nash? Come on, dude.
Yeesh. Hey, you know, look at me. I mean, look at me. I've got more machismo than you do.
Okay, I'll be Kevin Nash. I'm gonna agree. Yeah, I'll be Kevin Nash.
Hey, yo. Another one for the bad guys. I even got the toothpick.
Nice.
Anyway.
I had no idea that was Scott Hall when I first saw him. I thought, man, look, that's not
razor. I went to Richmond to see a show, and he was there as a diamond stud with WCW. And I was like, who is this guy? Where did this guy come from? And then I found out later on Scott Hall was like.
Yeah, he was with Kurt Hennig in the AWA. It's like, oh, my God.
He had the little mustache, the roly finger mustache almost. But, yeah, wow. It didn't look nothing like him.
And he didn't look like he was on drugs either.
No.
Right before his addiction hit. Poor guy. Rest in peace, Scott.
Yep.
Yep.
All right. So that's going to do it for another episode on the fly.
Where can they find us, Stevie?
They can find us anywhere. Anywhere.
Do they want to find us? That's the question.
That's the question. Do they want to find us? Because if they wanted to, they can find us. You can find us on our YouTube channel, which you need to subscribe to. Check us out there. Any podcast platform that you can find, Spotify, Apple, Pandora. Check us out on Good Pods. If you're a member of Good Pods, give us a good review. Any of these places, give us a good review.
We'll be on LimeWire in the coming weeks.
Yeah, LimeWire.
Napster.
Yeah.
What was the other one? There was some more, too. I don't want to incriminate myself. Yeah. But, yeah, check us out there. And then you can check us out on Facebook. Warden's got two pages that he really takes care of. Is that 80s page and all things rock, hard rock, and metal. Yes, I got it right now. And then you can find us on our official pay group for the podcast On the Fly, which is getting close to 500 members now, and hopefully we'll get over that. But I'll tell you this, we hit a big, you know, it's for a small podcast like us that, you know, we're not out there as much as some other ones are. We hit over 15,000 listens this last week, and that, which is great. I think that's great. I was really, who would think that a little podcast like this would get listened to 15,000 times? And no, it's not me. Listen to it over and over again. I promise you.
There's something I need to tell you.
Yeah. Jason's been listening. Warden. I called him Jason. I called him Jason. But he's been listening to it like half the time now. So he takes a little bit off of me. But
I know that somebody celebrated a milestone birthday.
49.
I texted him the other day and I says, get ready for shingle shots and colonoscopies in your near future, because that's I went through when I hit 50 just recently. So
I've got one more year in the 40s, and that'll be it. Yeah, I had a birthday Sunday, so which we're recording on Tuesday. So
well, Wednesday for y'all, almost right.
almost 14 more minutes, but I appreciate all the people that sent me well wishes on my birthday. Even Warden.
He would have preferred cash, but a well wish will do.
Yeah, so, my Venmo is Cash App. But yeah, I'll just settle for a Meliella and a slice of pizza.
Or a 5-star review on iTunes.
5-star review, yeah. That would be great. A 5-star review on Apple Podcast, anywhere. That would be a great birthday present.
I keep writing them, Stevie, but you don't submit them. What the hell's up with that? Oh, I guess I can't do it.
I haven't seen yours yet, Warden. That would be kind of crappy.
I went to some guys named Tom and Zeus. I don't know what that was about. Yeah,
I know. You like them better than me anyway.
Yeah. They told you.
All right. Any last words, guys? Joe?
No, this was a lot of fun. I was looking forward to it. And it was cool ranking our guitar player. So
good idea. I heard it was your idea. It was a good idea.
Yep. That was Joe's idea.
I didn't know how good I would do with being a non-musician with, you know, a musician like you, Joe. So.
No, we did great. We drew great list.
Yeah, I had no Yngwie on it, so it was a good list.
He was right on the edge for me. I'm joking.
You know what I kind of miss? Tracy Guns. That should have been an honorable mention. That was, he's, I like Tracy Guns. I love LA Guns, though.
So, I like Tracy. Tracy's cool.
That would have been my top 10 in this honorable mention. I'm sure we'll get off this here. Oh, yeah. What about so-and-so? Oh, we got to do part two next week.
From Striper.
Who?
I like him.
Yeah. And a lot of people don't realize he plays a lot of the leads.
There's so many.
Yeah. All right, guys. We're about to go into Wednesday now. So, but you guys have a great week, and we'll see you next week on the fly.
See ya.
See you guys.